How Basketball Saved My Life is sponsored by the Hall at the Rail House, Norman's premier event space in the heart of downtown. Weddings, receptions, corporate events, luncheons, banquets, proms, parties, and more. If you're looking for a place to celebrate life, we hope you'll choose the Hall at the Rail House, located in downtown Norman. The Hall at the Rail House is a 100-year-old event space with wood floors, exposed bricks, and beautiful wood barrel ceilings. With plentiful parking and many packages to choose from, the hall is the perfect spot for your next event. For more information, please visit therailhousenorman.com or call 405-778-0003.
This episode is brought to you by Chris Express Drug, located in OKC. And for all your sports medicine needs, call 405-735-3950.
This episode is also brought to you by ME Labs. They have partnered with the State Department of Health in Oklahoma to bring you free COVID-19 tests. So go to www.emelabs.com to find a testing location near you. That's a major move.
It's a major move. Welcome to another episode of How Basketball Saved My Life. I'm your host, Twan the Don.
It's your boy, the Easy Button.
And we got a dope guest in here for you today, the homie Jelon Hornbeak, right?
Yes, sir.
I had to make sure I said it right. Hey. Spell tricky.
But he Jelon always bring football players in here. He brought me a basketball player.
I finally brought a hooper.
Let's get it.
Hey, so, man, yeah, we got a good guest in here, man. He's done a lot in his hoop career and still, you know, going on to do some more. So, let's go get into it, man. So, what's up, man? Where'd you start hooping at? What got you your first kick on this hooping thing?
Man, really, it was just my cousins, you know what I'm saying? It was really like a family thing. When I was little in L.A., I was the baby cousin of the family. So, you know how y'all treat the baby cousin. You know, you play defense, you know what I'm saying? You get all the rebounds.
Right. You don't get the score off like that, yeah.
You get to do nothing. So, I really, you know what I'm saying, I kind of had to grow a hunger based off of, you know, just
trying. You had to get that dog.
Trying to. It was like, shoot, my youngest oldest cousin was probably like a 6-year difference. So,
sheesh.
And nobody, they all believe in tough love, you know what I'm saying?
That's getting, how it is.
You know,
it,
you know
tough,
get your licks.
That's how
tough love is the only love.
You know what I'm saying? So it was like, shoot, you play defense. If you steal the ball, you get to play offense. You get
to dribble, right? I like that. So, hey, you better work.
Hey, you better go get that board.
So what age you feel like it was you started really getting to love a ball?
Shoot, it was probably like 10 or 11. You know, I went up to my mom's and by like 9, 10, I was like, hey, mom, I want to play ball. You know, can I play in the Y League? And she was like, nah.
Shut it down.
So I asked her again the next year. I was like, hey, mom, I'm trying to play in the Y League. Like, the coach said I'm good.
Right.
Like, he said, I just need my mom to sign out the info. You just got to fill out a form.
She's like, nope.
She was like, okay. This is the next year. She was like, okay, how much? I was like, 175. She was like, nope.
No.
So I'm like 10. I'm like, all right, you know what I'm saying? I'm tall. I'm a little bit taller, you know what I'm saying? A little bit longer.
Feeling
I'm
yourself.
Like, you feel me? I'm like, all right. You know, I'm looking at her eye to eye now. You know what I'm saying? She don't look down on me no more. So we eye to eye. So I was like, all right, mom, like, can I play in the Y League this year? You know what I'm saying? She was like, all right, let me think about it. So this year, I was like, all right, I'm finna call Granny. I'm finna get Granny this
back dope.
Always show love, though.
Hey, back dope, mom.
So I was like, Granny, I was like, I'm trying to play in the Y League. Coach said I'm
don't
good.
Say nothing to moms.
He already told me I could play last year, but, you know, mom's like, no. She was like, oh, mom said no? I said, yeah, mama said no. So she was like, how much it cost? I said, 175. She said, okay, I'm gonna call my brother, and then we're gonna come up with the money. And it was just like, from then on, that was like my third grade summer.
Okay.
Because I had missed that whole season. So they put me in the B League because they didn't know who I was.
Right. That's fine.
And shoot, I ended up making the A-team All-Star League and then just.
Same year.
Took off.
No matter where you put me, it's going to end differently.
See, my mind be right because I'm like, if my son, like, I don't want my kids to play football, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm like, if my son want to play football, I'm going to tell him, yeah. Because if I tell him no, he going to get hungrier and hungrier because your mom told you no. He was like, dang, mom, don't want me to play. I got to do this.
Right. Like, I would go to the parks, and I'm like, man, I'm nice at the park. Like, I'm like, I know I can play. Everybody, all my other homies playing. They playing in the Y. They play at the Boys and Girls Club. I'm like, man,
that's
where
I used to pop.
I'm like, man, can I? I'm like, man, I just.
I want some of this.
You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, I just scored 20 over here. I'm like, man.
Nah, that's what's up. Because I was going to ask, you know, the generation now don't come up hooping like we did. And that's what I'm going to say. Did you start at the parks, too? Because, you know, you from Cali. I'm from Cali, too. I know you from the south. I'm from the northern part. But that don't mean nothing. We still probably started at the same kind of park. So is that where you kind of get your love is the park hoop, right? That outside me. Love. All I me. Love it. I mean, don't ever change. So that's what's up, man. That's what's
hey,
up.
Hey, we do the same in Florida. That's how I got started. East Coast. No, that's how I got started.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Sweeping the glass off the court, and then we running it.
Hey,
like,
let's get it.
Heineken's. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
So, yeah. So, okay. So, we started in the Y League. So, that now that's that kicker because you said it was that money thing. So I know, you know, growing up in the AAU world, because we ain't got to that part yet, but that's probably where, you know, that AAU love started coming in. You're good enough, you know, you ain't gotta worry about paying no more. So how long did you play for the Y League?
It was just that one little summer stint, and then we went to, I'm ended up making like the city team.
Okay.
All city team. So we had this city tournament. And then we won the city tournament. I got the MVP. And then
boy.
From the city tournament, that's where it was like, oh, I play AAU. It was like, everybody here play AAU but me.
You. Right.
And it was like, oh, what AAU team you play on? I was like, what is AAU? Like, you know what I'm saying? But it was crazy because they actually put the little lower rims down.
Okay.
You were skying.
Dunking, they were like, yeah, you can't dunk no more. The goal's not gonna stay up, so I had to actually like stop myself from dunking because, you know, we played horse. I grew up like playing horse, yeah. So like
6 foot rim all the time, we
trick shots,
it.
Low rims, boy.
Loved it.
That was my boy playing 21 on low rims used to be so much fun, dog. Tip dunk.
If you get dunked on, you out.
Tip dunk, you out.
You gotta catch the air ball, you know what I'm saying?
Right. Catch the air ball, get back in, yes, sir.
And we all playing defense on the air ball like it's a jump.
Yeah, try to get it.
That's where, people don't understand. Playing 21 is really where you get your ISO. It's really where you get your irk and jerk.
Hey, and you know how to take a double team on 21.
Yeah.
Boy, it's like six of y'all. You got 19? The whole world on you.
The whole world. And you're getting fouled every time.
And you're getting fouled. ain't no foul calls. What?
Nah, come on. My favorite, too. King of the court in 21, man. I don't need no help. Clear out.
Yeah. Clear out. Step back.
So after that. So I'm guessing after that, that must have been where you started playing AAU after this.
Yeah, I ended up playing with a team called TG, meaning thank God. So off the top, my grandma was like,
it's a wrap. You playing for them, nobody else. God put them in your life.
That was it. But I ended up playing with like a little off-brand version. We just had the team like
name.
Sponsorship or whatever. So it was like TG Red. But it was cool because like red was my favorite color. It's like 04, so like the you know what I'm saying, the T Max, the Adidas jumps,
the black and red with the red tip. Yeah,
yes, we sir.
Know. So I was good. So yes, I was sir. Good. I was like cool. I was like, shoot, I can wear my T Max. You know what I'm saying?
You
like,
in there?
Okay.
I'm good. So we ended up playing, and you know I just kind of stood out. And so the actual like TG team for my age group actually was like, nah. I'm going to take you from our, this, you know what
little
I'm saying?
Raggedy team.
That just gets our name and sponsorship, and I'm going to put you on our real team.
Ooh,
and,
that's probably the travel team.
That was the travel team. And so from then on, then I ended up meeting one of my coaches, Coach Chris. He's like an uncle. He's actually from L.A. as well.
Tight.
And shoot, he would train me, you know what I'm saying? He would actually train me, but he would train me not about like, skill work and everything, it was all cerebral, you know what I'm saying?
Reading the
like,
game.
Okay.
It was like, all right, he'll pull out a pad and pull up a defense, like, how do you attack this defense?
That's
you know
there's
what
a gym, our first gym of the day. You
know that's a gym.
The first gym of the day. Go ahead, yeah, man, explain on to that, man. How you feel different. Like that helped you, man? Like, go ahead, what you was doing.
it was just, you know what I'm saying, like, our like, you know, a lot of people be like, hey, let's come to the gym. I'm gonna teach how to, you know, I'm gonna teach how to do this, teach how to do this. You know, I had people, Coach Rob Wright, one of the coaches of Carter High School back in Dallas, he taught me how to shoot a layup, you know what I'm saying? Like, I never knew how. And so it was like certain people taught me certain things, right. But it was all like basketball on the court. Until he was like, you got to use your mind more than anything. He was like, before we even touch the ball, you know what I'm saying? How do you even know what to do?
When you got the ball.
If you don't even know where, like, how do you know if I teach you how to do a, if I teach you all the handles in the world and you don't know how to attack the defense.
When, you don't know when to do it. I see that all the time, bro. Like, I guess it's on me because, like, one of the, like, I was talking to one of my coach's friends and I trained his player. And he was like, man, yeah, my man knows how to do this. He got all the moves, but he pull them out at the wrong time. You know, I'm like, well, damn. So now we got to do some film study. So that goes back to what you were saying.
So what age was this around when you getting this book work, you know, the pad work? What age you feel like this was?
It was like
around?
12. Like,
yeah, that's dope.
I'm like,
God, that's a cheat code.
That's
bro.
Dope, just, for real.
It was just like, it was things like that. Then we'll go to a random gym and be like, hey, go play everybody one-on-one. I don't care if you lose. I don't care how old they are. So I'm 12 years old, going against, playing against random people out here. They could be grown men. They could be 35 years old.
Right.
No matter what, he's like, play them one-on-one just one time. He's like, I don't care. He said, man, once you win or lose, play another one. And then play another one. And then play one. He was like, man, he actually told me this like.
That's a movie, dog.
Like a year ago.
I was like, that sound like some Denzel in.
he told me like a year ago. He was like, he said he told me that because he said he never wanted me to be afraid to challenge anyone.
That's
you know what I'm saying? Like, if you could challenge a random person that you have never met at the basketball gym, you should be able to challenge a person who you could watch a limited amount of hours of film on.
Facts.
And you actually know.
Damn. What they gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
Dog, what's his coach name?
You heard me, what he do now?
he still train baseline to baseline. He still got his thing going.
This in Cali?
This is in Texas.
Yo, you might need to link us, dog.
I need to.
He's good people. You know what I'm saying? Him and his son, he got two sons, Ken and Caden. Ken play overseas now, but it was really like this, us three, Drew Guillory, us four, we was just
getting it in.
We need you for season 3 because he gonna show you this. Like, so we need you for season 3.
With that, we used to play one-on-twos. Like, it was never one-on-ones. Like, it was anytime it was 21, it was you play versus two. You played against two people. You know what I'm saying?
Every time.
You gotta learn how to score against two people. It was like, okay, anybody can score against one person.
Right. And that's why I stopped playing one-on-one for a long time. And people thought I was being cocky and I won. I was like, I don't play one-on-one because there
ain't no help side.
And people laugh at me like, oh, he be, nah, like, one-on-one is easy. Like, if you do this, you do this. Like, you a score, I'm a score. I probably can't stop you on a one-on-one. You probably can't stop. Bro, it's easy. But if you got the help side now.
Now you really got to work.
And you getting buckets, now you a dog.
Now you got four others rotating over, already shading over, already playing. Then they can shade you and play you
they
into a gap.
Box
like, okay,
you in.
Well, it looks like you're locking me up. You
yeah.
know what I'm saying?
I guess I'm locked up.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm saying? But it's okay. That's when they come to the whole cerebral thing. It's like, okay, I see the shift. Now it's kind of, you just put everybody else, it's like chess. You just put everybody else in the place. So it's like, you can try that. Now I'm a
Jedi mind trick you. That's fire, dog.
I like that. And that's at a young age he started you with that, so that's real right there.
But yeah. You think about Rayford.
I was just about to say that.
Go ahead, dude.
Like, so we had talked about, you know, we had Rayford on the show. Mm-hmm. He was talking about how, like, at a young age, he had, I think it was like a film dude from the Orlando organization.
Orlando Magic.
Sending him. So I guess he used to break down certain point guards for whoever point guard was on Orlando.
Mm-hmm.
And he's sending Trey to film. So Trey, at a young age, getting film broke down on one guard. All film, and that's what he's seeing growing up. He sit with his dad, and they just walking through, you know, dissecting what the player do. I'm like, that's
a But eventually, he said Trae Young started getting film on Steve Nash,
right?
Which is one of his favorite guards, Steve Nash, Chris Paul. I mean, several others.
But
and
just,
so,
ISO film on just that one player.
And so, I mean, you look at Trae now, you like. You ain't like that by chance, bro. Like, yeah. You got all that success, full stop. We gonna get into that.
Right.
You ain't get to that by chance. You did the leg work. The leg work and the mind work.
That's
so
real.
That's litty, bro. Golly.
And it was just, I mean, I really credit a lot of that to my, like I call him my uncle Chris. And one thing about me was anybody from like my city, my neighborhood that wanted to go work out with me, I took them.
Yeah.
No matter if they had any aspirations of doing it, if they was with me and they say, hey, I want to try it, I want to see if I'm
built for this.
Come on.
True.
You know what I'm saying? It was, and anybody from my city tell you to this day, like, hey, like, I probably never played a lick of basketball, but I tried it. I thought I wanted to, and it wasn't for me. You know what I'm saying?
How many didn't come back?
A bunch. You know what I'm saying? But, you know what I'm saying? The door was always open.
For
you know
sure.
What I'm saying? And they respected the fact that, you know, it wasn't on no, like, oh, nah, you can't work out with me because... Oh, what I do is just, it's just too much for you. But at a certain point, you got to kind of get that mindset of, you know, you got to separate yourself.
Yeah, but they got to understand you are someone who is working towards this. I'm bringing you in to get a chance, but this is what I'm working towards. So they're going to understand the separation if it ain't for them. So.
And that's what they did, respectfully.
That's real.
Speaking of separation, clearly by this time, you're separating yourself from your peers. So... You about to get into high school at this point, right? When the major TG team came and scooped you. You going in high school at this point?
No, I was actually going to middle school.
I'm gonna say he's 12, so he got 12. In seventh, young. Eighth grade.
And I was young.
Everybody
actually,
ain't me, I'm sorry.
Why you say that?
Because I went to high school early.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah, I was regular.
Yeah, me too. I was honestly right up under regular.
Oh, regular, you hear me?
It's all good, though. It's all good.
Actually, my TG team kind of, you know, broke up and actually went to play with Team Texas, where I was kind of like one of the dudes on TG, and then I went to Team Texas, and I actually sat the bench. Mm. You know what I'm saying? That's when, you know, I really was just like...
Out of work.
You know what I'm saying?
Just, so, TGT was in L.A., right?
TG was in Dallas as well. It was just like the top Adidas team in Dallas.
So
back
when
then.
Did you actually? Because that's what I wanted. When did you move from LA to Texas? What age group was that around?
Oh, I was like five. I was young. Okay. I was real young when
okay,
we came
so
out
you
here.
Okay, so you got it in the works in Texas then.
Boy, okay. You a Southerner. No.
for sure. But most of my family's still out there, so you know 100. What I'm saying? I can't forget about them.
At all. No doubt. No, that's how I be feeling too. I still got the 916 area code. So.
Yeah, he ain't giving that up.
At all.
I already transferred to the 405 area code. I don't even care. So boom, check it out then. So you went from being the main dude to sitting down, and then obviously you got past that because you went on to do big things. So how was it for you to be like, man, I gotta sit this bench. What do I gotta do? Like, what was your mindset like to get over that hump?
It was kind of the craziest thing. It was me and Marcus Smart used to sit the bench together.
No way.
Wow, I would not believe you saying that.
Like, that threw me for a loop.
Right.
And like he used to never really complain. He used to just go in there and hoop. And I was just, I kind of mimicked that. And, you know, those times where, you know, we down 20, 30, and it was just, all right, y'all go in there, we'll bring the game back.
Yeah.
They'll take us right back out. And, you know,
and
it's
lose.
Just like,
I hate those moments.
Well, they'll leave one of us in, you know what I'm saying? It kind of, I guess, I really wouldn't know, but they kind of knew, like, you know, one of us was kind of like
noise.
And it was cool. One day it'd be me, one game it'd be him, you know what I'm saying? It would be things like that, but it kind of frustrated me and made me, you know, want to work out even more. And I want to say my uncle, it was at a point of time where, you know, he was just trying to pull out new tricks, you know, and this is when it was like a reaction ball. It was like real cool and new, and he was just working on your lateral movements with reaction balls, and he was just like, you just got to put the work in. And probably like seventh grade, I told him I just want to play football. He trained me to actually just be a quarterback. Just so I could just, you know, just...
So this whole time you playing football too? Okay.
And it was like just, you know, just kind of let it go. Just kind of use that, you know, use that aggression, whatever you feel, and, you know, just let it play out. And by like seventh grade, I actually like left Team Texas just because I wasn't playing.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm playing on like the top team in Texas, so we had to pay. So it was like I'm paying to not play.
Facts.
My mom's like, I'm like, nah, I'm like, the people is cool. Like, you know, them still my homies to this day, but it was just like, nah, I had to go somewhere else. So I just kind of went to like a small AAU team and kind of just, I was the only person there in my age group. I actually had to play 17s at 13 and just so I could play.
Bet that helped though.
Hold on, what? You played as a 13-year-old on a 17-year-old team?
Mm-hmm. 17 and under. I've been playing 17 and under since I was 13 years old.
Oh, my goodness, bro. Yeah. You had some opportunities.
For real, for real.
That's dope. That's why you're so cold. It makes sense. It makes all the sense, but go ahead. Yeah,
so at 13, when you first started playing with them, was you getting busy right off the back, or did you feel like you was work? You had to...
So it was like right before, it was like a month before that, my uncle actually told me for the first time I actually played good.
He told you that?
Yeah, like I played good.
Gave you a compliment.
He said I played good. You know what I'm saying? I think I actually played my age group. I had like a triple double. And he was just like, yeah, you played pretty good. And I was like, shit.
When's the next game?
I played better than you, but you saying good, okay.
When's the next game?
Like, it don't matter. He was like, nah, you should have did this, this, and this. And you should have attacked here at this angle. You should have did this move. And he was like, nah. I don't have anything bad to say. It's like, you know what I'm saying? Bed up right for your mom. Yeah. Your crib is clean enough for your mom not to say that she needs to wipe anything down. You know what I'm saying?
That's rare.
That's rare. You know what I'm saying? Rare. You know, and it was just like, I was like, man. And he was like, yeah. So he was like, don't play age group no more. And I was just like, what? I'm like, don't do it again. I'm finna kill everybody in my class. I'm finna be this, this, and this. And he was like, nah, go play. He was like, go play up at least 16 and under, but preferably 17 and under. And so, Coach Pat, mind you, I'm playing with my, like, pretty much guys from my neighborhood, my city.
Right.
In AAU at this point. I was just like, forget it. I'm gonna just play with my homies and then we just gonna go all over.
Just have fun.
Right.
If we're gonna be good, we're gonna be good. I'm gonna be good with my homies.
Straight
and
up.
It was just like that. And then it was at a point in time where I was playing with them and the 17 and unders. And it wasn't until I actually went into my freshman year of high school where I had to choose.
You had to choose? Why'd you have to choose?
Number one, my neighborhood, everybody from my neighborhood, they went to a different AAU organization just because they had like the hype, the money at that time. And I was more on loyalty because they gave me the opportunity when I was really a bench warmer. So it was like, I'm not finna lead these dudes because they stuck an arm out when nobody else would.
Because the grass ain't greener. They let me turn up.
And so I was like, well, I respect y'all. Y'all still my homies, but I can't leave. So I was really the only person from like a 13-man roster that stayed in my age group. So they was like, just play 17s. And that's when it started.
So you said you was playing football too. When did you give up football?
So I was supposed to actually, so my eighth grade year actually had like a pretty good year, you know what I'm saying? Kind of like really developed the long ball, you know what I'm saying? Like a good over the shoulder type of long ball. And so I caught a few eyes from one of the brand new high schools. They wanted me to come start varsity as their quarterback.
Sheesh.
And, Timberview, the school I ended up going to, they wanted me to play JV. And then move up for playoffs.
Right.
And I was like, cool, I'll do that. Just because they was better, more established. Like the other school, they was a brand new.
Right. You don't know what to expect.
Like, yeah, you know, you gonna be quarterback. I don't know who.
But you throwing to some 5'2" guys.
So I was like, nah, but this crazy thing is one of the guys actually from that team and playing for the Redskins, well, Washington's.
Right
for the Washington's
football team.
Oh, wait a minute, I must have missed that memo. The who?
The Washington's football team.
Is that what they call now? Yeah. Oh snap, bro! Yeah. I missed that, bro. Yeah, that is lame.
Almost said the wrong thing. So the Washington's.
Right.
You know, that is lame.
I did not say
that. I get the name change, but do better.
Do better. Washingtons?
Well, they don't have a name, so they just call it the Washingtons until they come up with a name because they don't really have a replacement.
I mean, hey, y'all get me on staff. I'm going to get you with a name.
Well, all the names that they wanted to pick, I think some dude copyrighted all of them, so he trying to make them cash out for
yeah,
it.
Yeah, that's
dope. Something like that, that's what
get
I heard.
Get your paper there. People do that with websites, too.
Yeah, that's what I said. We can launch them. Yeah. Done already. Yeah. So, yeah, okay, so you dual athlete. You dual athlete this whole time. So you can't leave that out, bro. We
my bad.
This whole time. I mean, we hooping.
Well, I was nice and track too.
See, he was nice and track
you
too.
You gotta explain to the world these things.
Oh, my bad. Seventh grade.
All right, let's start over. No,
nah, man, I gave up track. I didn't like the short shorts. Like my seventh grade.
I was like, bet you hooping the short shorts now though.
Nah.
What?
Hey, he from our era, bro.
For real.
We need our shorts to go tight. Bro. At least right above. We good.
And we barely used to wear it right above. I just got comfortable with the shorts.
I just start showing some skin about right. Ah.
You know what I'm saying? I think it was the kids gave me cool with the dad legs. Before that, no shirt.
He said, I quit track because of the short shorts, bro. I feel that.
Nah, I was about 5'10". I jumped 6'4".
Ooh.
In seventh grade. And they was like, probably broke all the city. I broke all the city records. And then that was it. I was like, I'm done. I can't do it.
He broke records and broke off and left.
I can't do it. It's,
shoot. Yeah, she'll tell you, I only did it one time. Fell over the hurdle one time, and I was done for. And I used to do good at triple jump, but that was enough for me. So track, okay. So football. So like, I know you had to pick eventually. How'd you kind of decipher when you was gonna pick?
So when I went to my public school, Timberview, I actually chose to go to Timberview. He kind of recruited me there, low key.
We ain't gonna tell.
The varsity coach, low key, did. But when I went there, they had me choose either basketball or football. They said they didn't want me to play both.
Why?
So,
I ain't never heard that.
Crazy. They was like, at this point, I was already starting on varsity. So he was like, if you play football, I'm going to put you on a freshman team of basketball. And I was just like, nah. I don't love football that much.
I like it.
And he knew that. So he was smart. He was smart for that.
But it's crazy because, like, in this, like, mid area, I noticed the high schools do that more. Because, like, and on the West, they don't care. They're going to let you play both.
Yeah.
I feel like maybe on the coast. But, like, here, they so stuck on, like, you need to play it. You need to play one thing. And I started noticing that it's hard for a lot of people to be dual sport athletes.
Here.
Oklahoma, Texas area. Because, you know, they big on their college sports here.
Right.
So I realized that here, being in this town.
Because they trying to breed football players for real.
For real.
In Texas, they play football. They got AAU football, pretty much.
You know what I'm saying? I ain't know that.
So not Pop Warner no more. They done switched to AAU
football. Well, I mean, they got the Pop Warner, but you know what I'm saying? They have like the,
club teams.
So like in middle school, we actually would have like, I call them AAU football coaches coming to our middle school games and like asking like, oh yeah, what you doing? Like, all right, I know you can't play Pop Warner no more, but until you get to high school, you got this 2 years, you can
play. Bro, that's AAU.
That is AAU.
AAU.
That's what it is.
That's what I call AAU. So I said, it's football AAU out here. And I was like, man, I didn't know. And shoot, even in high school's spring league, they 7-on-7, they have like a national, it's like an actual like championship.
Oh, that's fire,
like, you
bro.
Actually go, to make it. You actually go to like A&M for the championship game and play for like an actual like 7-on-7.
Most sports need to have AAU first of all.
Yeah,
that's really what I mean. I know volleyball do it.
Mm-hmm.
Basketball, I didn't know football did it.
But with all this social media, it's what it's gonna come to anyways, man. Because AAU is more popular than high school sports these days. So it seemed like that's what everything gonna go to anyways. And men and
because you can get the best players on one team. In high school, it ain't like that.
Right.
You know, like,
you gotta go to that high school.
You got a pool of players, no matter how good they are, some of them gonna make that team, because that's just what you got.
I swear.
Eventually, these AAU players, or AAU coaches, gonna get paid more than these high school coaches. That's what I'm thinking.
Oh, they do.
Yes. No, they do.
Well, there you have it.
I get paid more to coach my AAU team right now than I do at my high school I coach. I'm a freshman coach at a local high school here, and I get paid more to coach my AAU team, just flat out. Like, I will not miss my AAU practice. I would not miss that, and I would not miss my tournaments, because one, you know what I'm saying, you ain't got some of the pressures that you have of coaching for a school. You get to be yourself more, so can't beat that. Can't beat that.
So, did you go to that prep school right off the bat? Is that what that is? That your school? Is that the school you're talking about? That's not the prep school, right?
I went public school for my first year. Played varsity. We went to the Final Four. We ended up losing to Houston Yates, which is like one of the actually had like a memorable, like a real memorable run during that year. Beat a team about like 100. You know what I'm saying?
Golly.
Dog. Yeah, rival at that. Yeah, it's
they ain't beat y'all by 100.
Nah, they beat us by 25, which was actually not bad that year.
That's
they were that nice. Who they had on their team?
Shoot.
If you could remember.
You lose by 25 and get respect.
Oh, like. I was a 14 true freshman. I was one of the only people to dribble through their press and get a layup.
Right. Right.
And like that was like a big thing. I didn't even know. They was like, hey boy, you dribbled through the press, got a leg. I was like,
okay, I do that my whole life.
Like, ain't nothing to me.
But nah, they really had like a legendary like type of defense. Joe Young, who got
overseas.
Mm-hmm.
Charles.
What Charles?
We kick it with him a lot too. I'm gonna have to look it up, but the homie Charles, he was Mighty Joe, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was with him overseas for a minute, training with him. You know Charles?
Probably do. I'm drawing a blank.
Mike, is a dude. Tiny went up going to SFA.
Stephen F. Austin.
Mm-hmm. They had Brandon Peters, called him Snap. He was like the 5'10" with like a 50-inch vert. Man. Yeah, it was crazy. Like he was like the foe man, but he was like that. You don't understand, like,
I
didn't see him catch a lob like this, and then he like switched it up, put it to the right, and then he was like, nah, on the way down, threw it back in. But he like legit 5'10".
Changed his mind in midair, bro.
I'm just like, man, I'm like, ain't no way.
Let me step this way.
Yeah, like, ain't no way. I said, yeah, he got it. We just gonna take the ball out.
Yeah. So then when did you end up getting ranked or start picking up your stars?
Shoot. It was probably after I left my public school, ended up going to Grace Prep my sophomore year. And
what made you change? What made you make that change into that?
Number one, the head coach ended up leaving, going to Duncanville, which Duncanville was kind of like the school back then. This was like right after Perry just left. They had Sean Williams, Roger Franklin, all these, Reggie Dow. These are all like high major
prospects
coming out of one public school. And so it was like, shoot, like if I could, a lot of people, it was like one of the biggest schools in the city. It was just like a real gold mine. Like, they're good now. You know what I'm saying?
Sound like a mini Oak Hill.
But it's a public school.
Right.
And it's really in the middle of the city. So it was like, it's a good area compared to, like, he really built up from, like, he really put in work to build up what he did at the school I was at, Timberview. So, you know, he kind of deserved it. The assistant coach, who's the coach now, still is the coach now at Timberview. Me and him always didn't see eye to eye, but he's still a good coach. Like, they've won championships since. Right. They've still won three, I think, state championships.
That's real mature of you to know that. It's all right to know this dude's a good coach, but we just, you know what I'm saying, basketball-wise, it just we don't mesh, and that's all right, you know what I'm saying?
It was just, my thing was, you know, like, he just didn't have any connections with college coaches.
And which is what you was looking for.
And like
there it is.
And like the most connections they really had at that time was like, you know, JUCO and
so you knew early, I'm going to college for this, like, knew early.
So my head coach gave me this, my first letters from Wichita State. And so he was like, he said, hey, I didn't want to get this to you during the season. I kind of want you to focus. But, you know, he got a little questionnaire from Wichita State, you know, like...
This freshman year?
Mm-hmm. He was saying, he said,
you have a, he gave me some JUCOs, but he said, hey, like, I really want you to focus on these type of schools. You know, that's really where I see your talent.
That is.
That's what's up.
And so,
that's the coach that went to Duncanville.
He was the coach that left, you know what I'm saying? So it was like, man, like, this really the dude that really believed in me. Right. You know what I'm saying?
Know where I belong.
And like, it wasn't no offense to the assistant. It was just like, we really had that type connection. Of connection. And like I said, he kind of recruited me as well. So it was like,
take you with him?
It would have been against some. We would have broke a lot of rules. Cause I was gonna have to like move like two different cities over, and it was just been a whole bunch of red flags. So it was all out of respect. He got the pay raise, everything that he deserved. No, and,
so did he kind of put you onto that prep school? Did he kind of help you after that, kind of make that decision, or that was all solely on you?
Nah. So want to say it was by like sixth or seventh grade summer, I met this guy, Tyson Williams, like a play brother. He's a strength and conditioning guy. I met him through one of my good friends who played on my TG team.
Okay.
He said he works him out, and he was like, hey, you know, he's good. He doesn't charge a lot. You know, you can come work out with him. And, you know, he works with parents. So, like, that was, like, the thing with my mom. Was like, if he could work with me on a payment plan. You know what I'm saying? That was another thing. Shout out Uncle Chris. Like, you know, if you could work with us on a payment plan, like, I may not have it this week. You know, my mom does hair, so it's like,
right.
It fluctuates. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah. Like, it was like, hey, I might not have it this week, but, you know, if you could train them, I'll gladly
pick up.
Play you when I have it the following week or the week after. And them being the dudes that they was, they didn't never turn me away. And right. So, Tyson, he actually got fired for training me at 24 Hour Fitness because I didn't have a membership, and he was just training me out of, what I'm saying, just out of off the strength, just because he knew I didn't have the money for the membership, but he really saw that a lot in me that he was going to try it anyway. We actually got it going for a little bit, but they ended up catching on, ended up firing him, but I wasn't the only one, but you know, I know I was part of it.
You was being a gym rat that I'm thinking that you are. You was in that thing faithfully.
I was a part of it.
And it's 24 Hour Fitness. So I miss them. Dog. I miss them, bro. That's where I grew up. After playing outside, it was 24 Hour Fitness.
Straight up. Midnight basketball in that thing.
And so it was just straight strength and conditioning. He ended up becoming their strength and conditioning coach for Grace Prep.
They did him a favor.
so
he took you with him to Grace Prep.
He was there before. He told me to go there before I even went to my public school. And I was like, nah, I ain't going to no prep school. I'm going to go to high school with the homies. And
yeah, straight up.
You know what I'm saying? You know,
freshman year.
I'm like, boy, I'm trying to go to prom. And
ain't it crazy, though, our outlook on prep schools back then? Like, back then, I'm not preppy.
Right.
Preppy.
Exactly. That was the main thing.
I'm not preppy.
Uniforms.
No, right.
Uniforms?
Nah. I know. That probably would have been the best.
You got to comb your hair? What?
Yep. No mush, no facial hair. It was all that. I was like, nah, I'm good. And eventually, it just ended up being the right situation. They ended up, like, the guy before there, Nick Russell, he ended up going to K-State. So, he was, like, one of, like, the big... big recruits coming out of the city outside of the people that left to go from Duncanville. Right, so it was like, shoot, it's only two people from the whole city that went D1 that year, and they was from
Duncanville and Prep.
And so it was like, shoot, I need to go.
One of the two.
That's what's up, see? And, hey,
he as did his homework.
That's what I'm saying. As you understand, he talked about he wanted to go freshman year, kick it with the homies. But, you know, when it came down to crunch time, hooping was more important. So he put that uniform on and cleaned that face up.
I swear.
Was you early facial hair guy?
I kind of had a little peach fuzz mustache, but you know.
Ooh, and back in them days, we wanted to hold on to them, bro.
You know what I'm saying? When you first get that little hair on the lip, it's like.
It's a wrap, dog. Like,
you hear me?
I'm a man,
You even start trying to talk with a deeper voice. Hello?
At the barber, like, hey, man, you forgot something.
Yeah, right. Like,
hey, you can touch up over here.
Yeah, you know, straight up.
I know somebody who like it.
Yes, sir. Nah, you did your homework, though. That's dope. See, like, that's
and you young, man. So, pops in the picture?
Nah.
See, and that's one thing we like to speak about, you feel me? Like, his pops really wasn't in, mine wasn't. So, like, we talk about that guidance point on this show a lot because, like, there's a lot of shit that we miss coming up. Like, me, my grandma was born in, I was born in Okinawa, Japan, so I got a birth certificate for that. But, you know, everybody thinking you got to go to high school, got to go to college, got to do it that way to make it to the league, where I could have been in Japan hooping and didn't really realize that until it was too late. Guidance is key. So, it's like, when you was going through this, was it the people around you helping you with all these decisions, or you feel me, you just really did your own homework to keep yourself on track?
Like, the reason why I call him my Uncle Chris is just because, like I said, it was about ball, but it was more so cerebral. He just, so like his son Ken, he was probably like one of the coldest people I ever seen, as well as Willie Warren. They went to North Crowley.
Mm-hmm. And my homie Darius Alford went there too.
And so, like, Willie wanted him, just won the state championship. I'm watching my he like, at this point, he like my cousin.
You watching your cousin.
You know what I'm saying? And he had just torched middle school, like, you know, hitting all these records, 50s and 60s. Sheesh. And the 70 ball. And I watched him hit game winners. I'm like, man, like, he goes to North Crowley right after Willie. Willie had just came back from Oak Hill and takes them to a state championship. And I'm just like, man, like,
you're following up.
I'm like, man, I can't wait. I can't wait. And, you know, it was just my Uncle Chris, he was just saying, like, hey, you know, maybe you should go to a place that schools already know. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, I understand, like, we're at this point of Texas back then, you know. It wasn't a whole bunch of Ballers Life. Like, Ballers Life really started my senior year on my way out the doors when Ballers Life
came out here,
you know what
Ballers
I'm saying?
Life came around when World Star came around.
Right.
After we was through and through.
Right. It was done for, you know what I'm saying? It was like, if you didn't, like, it wasn't big to bring to record games or to had a phone
even
out. Like, that wasn't,
like,
that wasn't big. So
nah,
it was,
because now you, like, thinking you all that, and people are like, oh, look at him, you know what I'm saying? Who you think he is? Like, that's really how it was, bro.
Like, it was like, man, you see this person's dad up here filming everything? Look at this geek, you know what I'm saying?
Like, right, for real.
That's how it was, bro. Like,
you see him up here with the camcorder, like, whose father is this? Like, I'm finna go at him. Whose father is this?
Right.
But now everybody and they mama and they going live.
It's normal. You know what I'm saying? Normal. It's normal. And it was a lot of things that was probably missed, but, you know, it's all in planning. But he was just the guy that kind of, like, always made me think before I do, you know what I'm saying? My coach Tyson, he said, hey, this might be a good situation. You always be able to train with me. So my mom was like, okay, good. It was a Christian school as well as a prep school. So Granny was like, you gotta go.
TG all over again.
You already know. She said, oh, you gotta go. You know what I'm saying? They had chapel on first Mondays of the month. She was like, oh, yep, you need it. You know what I'm saying?
Anything that had chapel.
You need it. And so, and then the head coach was actually one of the AAU coaches for Team Texas, one of the top AAU programs.
So Buku connects.
But he actually started as one of, like, the Arlington Swoosh coaches. So he was actually, like, he knew the people from the city, and he actually took, you know, a lot of the so-called underground talent and mixed them with the, you know, the top talent and on the AAU circuit and went to go and was, you know, tearing up the AAU scene. So, you know, coaches knew him at that point. So it was like, okay, you'll have it's practice, you have like a Missouri coming, you have North Carolina, Georgetown, Duke, K-State, that's Texas, love. OU, Oklahoma State. Like, this is the people that was on a regular, you know, will call him and say, hey, I'm coming today, what you got, what you gonna do? And like, he'll be like, all right, I was gonna run them to death, but.
but I'll get you some.
I guess they can hoop today.
Right, you know, I guess I'll give them a break.
We'll roll the ball out a little bit. I'm telling you, man, like Rick Pitino, Louisville. I'm telling you, it was just a list of coaches that would just come through. That was just off his connect. So I was just thankful. Not only did I go there, but Isaiah Austin went there as well. He was like number two or three in the country at that time. Jamal Branch went there. He was a class above me. He was still top in his class at that time. and Nick Banyard was there. And we just kind of took that, we added that to the team that they had, and took off the following year. E-Man grew up around the corner. E-Man Moutier grew up around the corner. So we took him, and then Micah Seaborn, we added him as well. And we just
and Jordan, this all at the prep school.
Yeah, and we added Jordan Mickey. He ended up going to LSU.
So that's the prep school Moutier was at?
Yeah, and then he went. It didn't go to prime prep.
Okay, I was growing up. I used to hear about him when he was at the prep school. Mm-hmm. No, you know, back then you were young, but you're not really thinking of actually with prep school. But that's
well, plus we couldn't get on something and just watch a video of him, so we just got to hear what we heard.
Right, that's real.
Like E-Man was kind of like the one that like brought Ballin's life to Dallas. You know what I'm saying? Julius Randle kind of started it, and then E-Man kind of like.
Ran off with that thing.
You know what I'm saying? It was like, oh, well, E-Man, like, you know, at that point, he was at prime prep. He was at Grace Prep with us, but after the 2012 year, when it was me and Isaiah, we had graduated. We had like 8 people, but everybody out of that 8 all had scholarships somewhere. That was something that we was real big about because we had all the spotlights. So we was like, our coach, Coach Ray, used to tell us, he said, if y'all play good enough, everybody on the team will get a scholarship to play somewhere for free.
And like, y'all don't, like, not no one person got to go do it all type.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he would make sure that, you know, everybody was a part of it. He said, yeah, you don't play on this team, but there's a lot of people that would not play on this team. But they understand in order for you to sit on this bench
you
on
be
this
cold.
Type of team, you had to put in some work, you know. You had to commit yourself.
At least be some type of good.
And so, like to this day, I take pride. Like everybody in my senior class got a scholarship somewhere. NAIA, like D2, like I don't like it's a scholarship. You know, it's free. It's free.
And you get to still education. Play what you love.
Free education. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people don't get that. So I take, you know, what I'm saying, I take pride in that to know that.
That's fire.
You know, everybody on that team.
So you still ain't tell me though, when'd you pick up them stars though? Cause you was a 4-star athlete.
Shoot, it was probably like my sophomore year.
Well, you picked them up early.
I think probably like my freshman sophomore year, cause I was playing up 17s and a lot of people didn't know me. I was just a little skinny, small kid out here just, who is the shooter? You know, who is he, like, who is this little skinny kid out here? I know he ain't 17, like. And it was just.
And that's back when we wore baggy jerseys, so you was probably.
Reversibles. Y'all remember them heavy reversibles?
Them bugs.
Davidson jerseys.
Yes. Nah, bro, like when the Monstars finally gave them boys their powers back, how them jerseys was dragging.
How he looked rookie year warrior jerseys.
Yes, bro.
No, shorts probably like.
And one mixtape.
You hear me? Sheen, big jersey. I had the tank underneath, so the tank was like
sheen
so tight. But then the jersey just, it was just
you
bad.
You did a move this way, the jersey went with you. Hey.
It was bad, man, but it was a learning experience. I had a few bad games, but it never looked like I didn't belong out there. And it just kind of like built my confidence up. And like I said before, I never got a chance to play my age group after that. So I just kind of had to like accept my failures as if, you know, I was playing with my cousins, you know what I'm saying? Where, you know, it was bully ball, you know? It was like, oh, if you get the ball, you get to play offense. And you know how many times they want to play defense? They don't want to play defense. So even if you about to get the ball, they going to push off behind the back. I don't know, you failed me. Nah. You fail, you know what I'm saying? You trip, like, no, I'm telling you, this is just, I always had tough love, so when I got received tough love anywhere else, it just felt regular, you know what I'm saying? It was whatever. And then by the time I was, my sophomore year, my Deion Houston ended up passing one of my friends that we played AAU with. We actually was going to play AAU together. He ended up passing before we could, and, it was a spot on the LeBron Skills Challenge, you know, Kingwood Classic. It was after my sophomore year. I had just left Grace Prep. I mean, just left Timberview to Grace Prep. We just lost in the championship, and I'm still on the AAU scene. But at this point, you know, I'm playing up. I'm that kind of that dude now that's playing up. They know me as the, all right,
played high school already. We know, we remember you from high school, so you know we expect a little more. And you know, I'm 14 playing 17, so it's like, okay, like I know I can play. I played varsity, you know what I'm saying? I went to the state championship. I know I can hoop with y'all at this point. So I'm kind of, you know, showing they know my age, but now I'm separating myself a little bit.
At a young age.
They gave me this opportunity to go to LeBron Skills Challenge, man. I went out there and, you know, my eyes was kind of big at first because, you know, it was like, number one, you see LeBron, and, you know what I'm saying? It's like, man.
But like, he really right here.
At that point, you know, they do the college thing as well. So, like, you see all the college stars. So, like, you see the Georgia Tech Iman Shumpert, you know, he was like, oh, that's your twin. Like, we in the elevator. He said, oh, that's your little brother. You never long lost your little brother. I didn't heard it all, you know what I'm saying? So, if anybody want to use that joke, it's bingo. So that's 10 years ago.
Yeah, straight up.
But, like, you know, like Nolan Smith, you know what I'm saying? Like,
and that's when he was a dog.
Nice.
I'm already knowing. Like, so it's all like, the bounce Nolan Smith.
You hear me? I'm like, I'm sitting up here. I'm like, man, like, Jared Sullinger from Ohio State. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, at Ohio State, Jared Sullinger, where he came in with the high school hype, and he was like, you know, like, it was just different, you know, it was really eye-opening, and so, like, I really had to kind of, like, settle in, because, you know, I was really, like, an add-in, you know what I'm saying? I was, like,
because your homie had passed, gotcha.
So I really wasn't supposed to go, but it was like, hey, do we have anybody in, like, you know, my class that could go? And it was like, well, we could send, because at this point, Team Texas that I had played with, they went to a different, they went to DC Assaults. So they became Texas Assault. So they went Adidas. So it was, it really wasn't a Team Texas. So, you know, I was just so happy to be cool with the head organization dude still. And he would, you know, give me shoes to play in tournaments for him, which I was like, hey, as long as so I'll pick you up, use the shoes as long as you play with me.
That's all he had to tell you, because I see the ice right now. Like, I've been looking at the dude right now, like, god damn.
You gonna give me some shoes, right?
That's how you gotta tell certain people,
especially back in our day, boy.
You hear me? It's like, man, I got all the Kobe's. What Kobe's you want? I said, well, if you give me two pair of Kobe's and some slides.
I'm good.
I'm with y'all weekend.
Right. You heard me. I ain't gonna have no complaining.
I had a good relationship with him, and so he
relationships.
That's what it was. That's all it is. Connections, man. Don't burn your bridges, man.
Don't burn them. That's a gem.
You never know. Don't burn your bridges. You know what I'm saying? And he made a call, said, hey, I'm going in somebody's place. They didn't have when I went there, they had no gear for me at first. They had to go, you know, get some more gear. I was a large. They gave me like the XLs, but I was like, cool. I don't care.
I'm here.
You hear me? I'm here. They gave me the hotel room. You know, it's like really one of the first times I'm traveling without the moms and stuff. Oh, like, man. You know,
had a cell phone yet?
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
I'm like, you geeked up.
It's really like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was like the college life before, you know what I'm saying? You really got the college. So it's like, oh, you really out here? You got a roommate. You really ain't got nothing to do. You just work out and eat and chill.
Right.
Bron got his barber in there. He got the whole little, like, mini basketball goals, all the foosball tables, pool tables, video games. So it was really like, you was really chilling.
Y'all
He had his chefs in there, so we eating like, I first tried salmon at like 14, man, hated it.
Y'all was laced up, bro.
That's what's up, though. So they finally got you some gear that fit, though.
Nah, it didn't fit, but I ain't care. I promise you I ain't care.
So did you bust some ass?
Yeah, it was like, so it's like a 4-day camp. It goes from the skills challenge where it's just workouts, and then like, you go to the King's Classic where it's just games. And so what I didn't know is that, you know, they got like the Kevin Durant skills, the Darren Williams, the Chris Paul. So it's all these positional camps that I missed.
Right.
And I just went to the big one, you know what I'm saying? The big hoorah. So I was really supposed to hit all these positional camps that I did it. And so I was really kind of like going there like, you know, it's really like.
So they already knew all these other guys because they done been to all the other joints.
Because they took the top ones from each positional camp and then brought them to the Skills Academy to put them on teams to go at each other. Okay. So I was really like my whole life, I just been thrown in the fire and then just like.
Put it out.
Diamond.
You hear me? Like, just
figure it out. And so I want to say it was like, so for, first of all, I played with Anthony Davis right after he hit his growth spurt. Like,
oh my goodness.
Like, as soon as he hit his growth spurt, he was like, hey, bro, I used to be like 5'10". I'm looking at him like, nah, ain't no way.
Bro, you're a cabbie.
Ain't no way. I was like,
you're a big cat.
I'm like, bro, my best friend, Isaiah Austin, bro, he's 7 foot. He was 6'6 in the sixth grade. Like, he been tall. You know what I'm saying? Like, he been tall. Like,
get out of here, bro.
Like, ain't no way you go from 5. He was like, nah, bro. Like, and sure enough, and we up here playing one-on-one. Like, I played one-on-one with Isaiah. You know, he was like, you know, like, you could tell he was tall his whole life. You know what I'm saying? So I could hit him with some quick stuff and still get my layup off. But I was playing AD. I hit him with a quick thing. He must have sent my, I was like, yeah, you quick.
You was 5'10 yesterday.
You quick, my boy. But it was me, AD, Jamal Branch, actually, okay. from my school. He actually went out there. He was on my team. So I knew one person, so I was good. You know what I'm saying?
That's all you need is one.
Jahi Carson was on our team. He was one of the top PGs. He went to Arizona State. Who else? Rico Gathers from Baylor was on our team. One of the only person that LeBron tried to move and like hit him with a bow and like bounce back. You know what I'm saying? Like, and we in high school. You know what I'm saying?
Oh my goodness!
Yeah, he was like,
I need footage.
He was like, nah. He's like, nah, it's off season.
He had to reconsider.
Be really out here hooping, though.
No, I want to say I went against Rodney Purvis, man, and I think I had like a 20 ball against him and like Mike Kabongo, and it just kind of I kind of started turning some heads, and then I kind of got a little respect because, you know, it was just like, well, who is that?
That's when you picked up them stars.
Like, who is that to have a good game? I don't even know who he is. He don't have a name.
He was a fill-in. That's usually the best story.
Oh God, it is.
like Mike. You know what I'm saying? Everybody go down. Get this kid a jersey. He go crazy. You was really on your bow wow for real.
Like, I mean, the whole time I was kind of messed up because
Brody just.
And it was that weekend was the weekend of his wake and funeral and everything, his visual. So I had to miss that. So I actually called his dad and asked, you know, could I go? Because, you know, I don't want you to think that, you know, I choose.
I'm benefiting on him.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Like, I want to let you know, like, I will stay here if it's your wishes. But, you know, his pops was like, nah, like, I want you to go. I feel offended if you stayed.
That's respect.
You know, as a kid, you did that, bro? Like, bro, you was mature, real, bro.
Yeah, I grew up fast, man. And so, with his respect, you know, I went up going out there. And actually, the day of his wake was, like, the game. I actually, like, went crazy. So,
dummy.
Oh, he Anton'd you.
You feel me?
Six man.
Six man you.
You feel me? So it just kind of took out from there on me.
All right. Well, so now I know how you got your stars. When did you start getting them offers?
Actually, I started getting my offers as soon as I went to Grace. Crazy thing at Grace, I didn't really play that much, so I went back to the bench. So it was like
when you got back from the camp?
So when I transferred from I was starting at Timberview.
Oh, sophomore year, you was on the bench.
And then I had gotten a few fights in school, so they had brought me off the bench in the playoffs, which was cool because I had got suspended. You know, it's just the rules and everything, but. When I went to Grace, you know, they was like, hey, I want you to come here. So I was like, all right, bet. And they was like, man, why y'all want me to come here? And I come sit the bench. I'm like, you know, it kind of messed with me at first. But, you know, it just kind of, one thing it taught me was how to play with other players. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, like, major key.
You know what I'm saying? Like, how can you be effective in the game if you don't necessarily is the person that has to score the ball? You know what I'm saying? Like, it was kind of different because I had Jamal Branch, who was like, you know, almost like a dribbling maestro who would go get you a 30-point triple-double, you know what I'm saying, on a night, you know, any given night. But I also had Isaiah, who's a 7-footer in high school, so that's 20 and 15 at least.
Sheesh, minimum.
With at least 2-3 blocks, and it's like, well.
Posters. You had a strap.
I had a strap, but, you know what I'm saying, you also had people from the team before that's been there, you know what I'm saying? It's like, well, these two are the two high-ranked players, you know what I'm saying, with the name.
It's a hierarchy. So then when did your time come? After they left, maybe?
I was actually playing behind our foreman. He was like 6'8", Nick Banyard. And he wasn't having too good of a stretch. And I told coach, I'll play the foreman.
I'll do whatever you want me to do.
I just want to get on the court.
And, dog, that's a gem. Because kids these days, I'm a one. You miss the opportunity to get on the court and show you got one handles. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, I ain't a five. Man, I'm going to go play that five. I'm going to get the board. I'm going to push that mug coast to coast and do what I got to do.
I'm going to find a way. And so I was like, well, I'm an athlete. So I was like, I'm going to just use my athleticism as well as position, my cerebral. So
right.
I'm going to get my position. I know if I get my position, you either going to foul me or you're going to let me go. So it's like I just have to do my work early since I'm a smaller person. You know what I'm saying? Just have to find your advantage from a disadvantage. You know what I'm saying?
Yes,
find
sir.
Ways to kind of use it against them. And that's all it really was. I just had to, number one, I had to listen. You know, I had to listen to all the criticism, the constructive criticism. And, you know, you had to apply it as well.
Right.
And so what I mean by that was, I wasn't the person who could dribble the ball, you know, it's no shot clock. I couldn't just dribble the air out, give me a screen, come off, throw the lob. You know, I was the person that
wasn't your role.
I was the person that, you know, I was setting the screen to get the person open on a pin down, you know what I'm saying? And if I knew if I set that screen good enough, my man would help, I can get open, I can get me a quick bucket. You know, that was how I had to kind of think the game. But in the summertime, I could go back to
who you was.
I could do all this. And so, you know, I had to kind of think about it as, you know, just kind of well-rounding my game because I may not always be the best player out there. So I give a lot of respect to, you know, like my coaches for, you know, trying to tell me how to play ball within. You know, I used to get mad, like, why are we running plays? Like, let me just go one-on-one.
Let me just go get a bucket.
It was like, nah, you got to make the game easy. You know what I'm saying? It was like, you could really run plays. Like, you could run flex and score 50 points if you really wanted to, if you ran it right.
That's real talk, though. Well, I was in a high school game. This was my senior year. And we were so athletic, bro. So athletic. And we played some white boys. They came down to Daytona Beach, and they was from Kentucky. In a tournament, and they ran flex on us, bro, and they found out, just keep it 100, they found the dumbest player on our team and ran the action at him the whole time. Back door, back screen. Bro, we was down 25 at half, bro. flex, bro. Like,
and if you line them up paper to paper, the gap of talent, athleticism, all that is probably like this big of a gap. But
I mean, we were so much taller, bigger. You know what I'm saying? Like, they did not belong on a court with us, bro. They smoked us in the first half. We came back, you know, full court, 100, you know, locked down, sit down, still lost. Came back, still lost.
Because
25
late.
Is a lot.
It's too late at that point. At that point, they just go run the clock. They ran their offense to perfection, and they know they can. So now they're like, well, if flex work, I know this work, this work, that work. I know the stall work. I know the press break work.
It was bad, bro. So, that's a major gem, bro. That's a major gem.
So, he would tell me, like, you know, Kyle, like, man, they playing a 2-3. I hate when people play 2-3. Now, we just go inside and we got to run plays. And he was like, nah, bro. Like, said, how about if you set the best screen, you probably get most shots than the person you screening for.
Well, that's why they be using, like, J.J. Redick and Cal Corvin them as screeners. Because them boys, you got to stay with them boys. So the dude who getting the screen going to be open, or J.J. Redick going to get a pop three. You know what I'm saying? Stuff like that.
And then at that point, you know, my assistant coach, Coach Kenny, he was like, hey, like, I really wasn't like a catcher. I was really like a scorer. You know?
Right.
I'm like a
off the dribble.
You know, I could face up. Like, I like to face up, but, you know, to shoot, you know, I was off the dribble, got to get a rhythm and everything. And so he was like, hey, you need to just work on catching and shooting. Catching and shooting, you'll be a 10 times better player if you could just catch and shoot.
Right.
With this type of...
Simplify the game.
And this type of people that you play with, you know, like, We don't need you to go out here and one-on-one get us 30. We got Jamal to do all that.
Right.
I don't need you to be out here dunking on everybody. We got a seven-footer. You
know, right.
The paint's gone. You know what I'm
saying? Yeah. he don't sit in that mug.
The paint's gone. You know
so
what I'm
with
saying?
you playing with these two hot talents, how you get your name big enough to still get these D1s?
Where'd you go, by the way? You end up going to OU.
It was practice. I was kind of reeled in the game, but like in practice, it was more so of like I was playing the four, so I was matched up against all the taller players. So I had the 6'8", the 7 foot. The next year it was Jordan Mickey, 6'8", Kavar Shepherd, 6'10". Like it was just those type of guys where I was matched up against. So it was like, well, we doing one-on-one drills and they. And so, like, you know, it's like Pittsburgh in here, Villanova, Virginia
Tech. They seen you give these seven-footers the fits.
You know what I'm saying? And it's like, well, then, you know, I mean, shout out to Coach Ray because he knew the right drill. So, like, I was real athletic. So, you know, we doing, you know, two passes dunk. Like, everybody got a dunk. Three-man weave, two passes, everybody got a dunk. So, he's like.
Gotta look good.
So, we out here flying. At this point, mind you, my prep school doesn't have a gym. We didn't have a gym at that point. So, we work out at the YMCA.
Interesting.
And then we would actually ball another team's gym to play our home games in. We actually had to change in the girls' bathroom. Like, you know, we was, for us to be number two in the country, you know what I'm saying?
Straight really thugging it.
Straight thugging it, bro.
To be number two in the country, everybody like, oh man, y'all at that rich prep school, y'all making us like, ooh, y'all don't know. Y'all
behind
don't know.
The scenes.
What had happened was.
Y'all don't know. Like.
Dang.
And so it was really like the practices, man. That's why I was saying it was all about like the connects that, you know, my coach had that, you know, he was able to, you know, be friends and cool enough. So I ended up transferring from Oklahoma going to Monmouth. And the head coach at Monmouth actually recruited me from Vanderbilt. When he was the assistant coach at Vanderbilt at Grace, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was just a small world. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, Bill Selfton came, you know what I'm saying? This is when I had the slit in the eyebrows.
And we all went through that.
It was like, oh, whoa, no, no. He said, last person to have the slit in the eyebrows up here with the guns and everything. So they were like, coach was like, hey, that's the last time. Once my eyebrows go back, you know.
Once the eyebrows grow back, boy, don't cut them again.
I was like, all right, my bad.
So, hey, y'all listen out there, just be coachable, because the man didn't even play the position that he wanted to play and still got that D1 offer. So it sounds like all you got to do is be coachable, play your role, and do it and show out when you got that chance.
And appearance matters. I mean, just a slip, that's nothing to us. But for them, they associated with something else.
You know, back then, 08, 09, that was like...
That's the thing. You had your earrings.
Or the double hairline.
The double hairline, I ain't get into that one.
I ain't get that far.
But I'm just saying, that's what
it was a thing, too. It was a thing, because my mans used to have the ponytail with the double hairline, bro. Like, that was a thing. Dudes used
slit
to do it.
In the eyebrows with the earrings.
Slit in the eyebrows with the earrings.
If you had the slits with the earrings, you was good with the females.
And then if you got the low boy, like how your haircut.
You was waved up.
You had the beanie halfway on.
I swear.
You had the beanie just so you could show your crispy hairline. Yes, sir.
It was crazy, man. So it was like, man, you really had to like, you really got to watch, you know, the waves that you follow. You know what I'm saying? Like
you do.
It was.
Pay attention.
It was early, you know. I was 16 when I figured that out. You know, right. They wasn't tripping about my tattoos. They was tripping about my eyebrows, and I thought that was crazy. You know what I'm saying? Like,
because normally it's the tattoos,
right?
Especially back then,
as a 16-year-old.
Back then, you know what
especially.
I'm saying? You know, this is after the tatted up Boosie song. Everybody was trying to get tatted. So you know what I'm saying? So,
why'd you leave OU?
I was telling y'all about Micah Seaborn that came to Grace as like my play brother, still is to this day.
Right.
He ended up tearing his ACL my senior year, his sophomore year. Then coming back, he ended up hurting his knee again. So he ended up missing 2 years of AAU. Summer, he lost his sophomore and his junior summers at AAU, and you know how big
that's huge
sophomore and junior summers are. So all he had was like a summer, you know, his senior summer,
right?
In which, you know, by that time it's locked up, you know.
Hey, like, you over with
everybody has already made their pick. Mm-hmm. If they didn't, they didn't settle going. They didn't settle with somebody that they didn't even want at this, right, point, you know what, right, I'm saying? And they may be out of scholarships because, right, they just had to fill a certain quota. So he had one offer in Monmouth in New Jersey, and his parents wasn't too fond of him going from Texas to New Jersey by himself.
Right.
And when I went to Texas Select, I became kind of like the face of it. So he was always on my younger team. So I was kind of like the
mentor,
the mentor to all the younger teams, because I was like, okay, well, you know, oh, well, I don't have a dad. Well, Jelon doesn't have a dad. You don't see him. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Well, I got a bad attitude. Well, Jelon used to have a real bad attitude. Look at him.
And
you know
he
done
turned it around.
You know what I'm saying? So I was kind of like that dude that they would go, all right, he can't handle, you know, constructive criticism. Or, you know, my thing was I couldn't really handle my mom criticizing me openly about my game.
In front of everybody.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that would, like, you know, put me, like, nah, just,
you
know what I'm saying?
That took you over the edge, huh?
You know what I'm saying? Just, that's car talk. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's car talk. You know what I'm saying? Like, don't air me out.
For real, straight up.
Don't air me out in front of everybody. And, you know what I'm saying? Like, and I had a player, Alex Robinson. He plays the G League now. You know, he kind of had to deal with something similar. And it was just, I could actually kind of talk to him based off experience, you know what I'm saying? And so I was always the guy from whether it was a year or two or three or four, like something happened, Jelon, go talk to that boy. Oh, he ain't listening to me. He don't want to listen to coach. Jelon, go talk to that boy. Go talk to him. Go talk to him. So yeah. it just became natural. So when he called me, it was just like, you know, little bro, what you want? And when I was here at Oklahoma, he was one of the few that would, you know, go check up on my grandmother. I'm a granny's boy, so
straight up.
You know, he would always check up on my grandmother just because, you know, not like my grandmother gonna cook, she gonna lace you down with the Kool-Aid, like, you know,
yeah,
what I'm saying? It's not an empty trip, you know what I'm saying? It's not an empty trip, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, he would faithfully, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't like, hey, you know, I need you to go there. He would,
right,
just pull up.
And
then some, you know, miraculously, some way, somehow, you know, my grandmother might need something. And he was just so happy to be there.
He
could hold it down. And I'm like, you know, that's real.
Real.
That's real. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, he was like, hey, bro, you know, I don't ask you for nothing. He said, you know, I ain't never ask you for nothing, but, you know, I need this one thing, this one favor, bro. I need you to come with me to college. He said, I know how it is right now, Oklahoma. I know, because at this point, it was like me and Jordan Woodard going like back and forth for like the starting PG role, like who was, you know, managing the most minutes at the point. And I was a little in my feelings about it, but it wasn't to the point where it was just like, you know, I'm a fighter, so, you know, I was like, all right, you know.
So you're going to scrap for yours.
May the best man win, you know.
Straight
that
up.
Was my thing, so.
See, Jordan was supposed to come on this show, too. He ain't made it yet, so I'm glad I'm getting to your story first.
Right. Yeah, Jordan,
yeah,
the homie,
right.
Jordan the homie, for sure. But he was like, hey, by this point, I already told, you know, we already had our, you know, end of the year meetings, you know. LK, Ron Kruger was like, hey, you know, it's your team next year, you and Buddy, you know, we expect great things, you know, me and Buddy already said we was going to get a national championship, all this other stuff, and, you know, I told him I was coming back next year, and like 2 weeks later, you know, my little bro called, and so I was like, bro, you don't understand, if you would have called me like 2 weeks early, you know,
you might have had something, but,
you know, it's cool, so I was like, I don't know. And so he called me every day for like another like 2 weeks.
Dang.
And he was like, hey, man, like, he said, please, bro, please, bro, please. And I was like, all right. And so I called LK up. I was like, I need to have a meeting with you and stuff. So I'm up here telling LK, like, you know what I'm saying, I got to leave and all this other stuff. And he was like, well, go tell Coach Hill. He the one who recruited me here. And so I had to go tell Coach Hill. That was my dude, too. So, you know, we had a little heart-to-heart. He real dude. And it was just like that. Then after that, I told Buddy, Cause you know me and Buddy, that's my room. That's still my brother to this day.
Yeah. Shout out Buddy Hill, come on the show, baby.
Yeah, that's my boy. That's my boy for sure.
He out there in my hood.
But yeah, I know. Shoot, funny thing is, me and Buddy was actually roommates in the Under Armour All American dunk contest and 3-point shootout. We was actually roommates there before. We actually both signed the OU and came roommates here.
That's crazy.
And so, like, that's why I be like, yeah, that's my roommate. Like, we just...
lifetime roommates. Yeah, like,
that's my roommate.
So, do you think that... I know you did it for the brother, you did it for the family, but do you think that decision kind of messed up putting you somewhere further with basketball?
Yeah, just because of... at the time, no, because I was always going to bet on myself. That's just the type of person I am, bet on myself, my talents. I felt like, you know, you're good enough, they're going to find you no matter where you at type of deal. You know, so.
Well, I thought that too, and I was wrong.
You hear me?
Listen, bet on yourself, but you gotta get the right guidance. Because it's a little trickier than that.
And that's where I was like, you know, if I had a father, you know what I'm saying, he would have been like, nah, like,
boy, you're not going nowhere.
Not, you know what I'm saying, it's a time and a place where you could be more of a help, you know what I'm saying, like, I could have been more of a help now for him, you know what I'm saying, had I just stayed my path, did what I had to do, and, you know, maybe I could be making tons and tons of more of this, or I could have been in a better position, you know, this wise, where I could bring him along, right, and it can be more beneficial, right, for him versus,
you can pave a way for him
versus me trying to pave a way for myself and him, because that's
tough
and almost impossible, you know what I'm saying, right. So I just kind of made the road a lot tougher, you know what I'm saying, and shoot, I feel like, you know, if I had stayed, we'd have had a national championship with Oklahoma too, so
right.
Cause I always wonder, cause like I mean I ain't gonna lie, when I went kind of funneling to see everything you did, I was always wondering like, why did bro leave? Cause I never really knew why. I didn't even know you transferred. I just
shoot, Lisa didn't even know. Yeah, she didn't even know. Nobody really knew. I only told, you know, like a few, like my teammates who I, you know, right, I was there with, who I felt like, you know, I owed it to them to tell them face to face. You know, a lot of people. Like I was cool with, but you know, like y'all know when you playing sports, especially like college and high school, like when you put them off seasons,
yeah,
them off season works, like, you know what I'm saying, y'all, you lean on each other, you really become, you know what I'm saying, like them become your dudes just because, like, all right, I didn't think I was gonna get through this workout, but you know, my boy really got me through,
right,
and
right,
vice versa, you know, facts, what I'm saying? And that becomes like a routine for years, you know what I'm saying? It's like, I need bro, you know what I'm saying? Right. In certain aspects of this workout,
for sure,
you know what I'm saying?
Especially like, when they put them D1 putting you through them real fire, so.
And so it was on that type of level, so it was like, I owed it to y'all to tell y'all first, and then, told my coaches, and I told the rest of my teammates outside of my, outside of people that I like talk to daily, you know what I'm saying? And shoot, I didn't even really tell my mom where I was going. I didn't really tell my grandmother. It was just kind of like a decision I made myself. That's why, like, I know if I had like a father, you know what I'm saying?
You couldn't,
like,
have got away with that
at all.
Cause I made all my own college decisions.
Me too.
And a lot of them weren't great. And I didn't tell my mom. You know, even in high school, when I was transferring from high school to high school, she was just signing off on it. But, like, she ain't know nothing about no basketball, so you want to go there? Okay. Like, okay, so then I got to college. Now I'm 18 or whatever. I don't need your consent. I bet. I'm going from here to here.
Right.
And I'm going to go from here to there. You know what I'm saying? So, boom. So, you get there, man. You have some success. Even take them to the NIT. Then you put your name up for the draft. What happened then?
Before that, because I know at Mon, was it Monmouth? Monmouth?
Mm-hmm.
You got in trouble there. Did that hurt you a little bit? Is that what kind of put you back a little bit, or what you think?
So, I mean, first and foremost, I hurt my back real bad when I was here. I think it was my freshman or sophomore year. I tried to dunk on somebody, landed on my back, and kind of chipped it up a little bit.
Yeesh.
And, you know, I just kind of, like, I'm you know what I'm saying, I'm kind of a tough kid. You know, my see my mother get up every day. She worked on her feet, you know, countless hours a day. She had a bad sciatic nerve.
Mm-hmm.
And I see her get up every day and still stand on her feet all day, you know, 12 to 14 hours a day with a bad sciatic nerve. So I kind of look at pain as, you know, all mental. So, like, man, I'd be like, all right, my back hurt. But I'm like, man, my mama back hurt. You know what
Straight
I'm
up.
Like, she back, her back hurt. She stand up on her feet 14, 15 hours. Like, I'm complaining about, you know what I'm saying, 2-3 hours of practice. Like, nah, man, shut up, man. Like, I'm good.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just, you know what I'm saying, that's just how I kind of, like, broke it down. You know what I'm saying? When it came to anything conditioning-wise, I felt like I was about to give up. It was more so, like, you know, I seen, like, my grandmother has, like, she had a bad car accident, broke her ankle, and her ankle grew back wrong, but, you know, her feet hurt, but she don't complain about it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Have never really complained about it, but it's like, my ankle hurt, I rolled my ankle, like, I can't hoop.
Right.
Nah,
my grandma ankle hurt.
Get your butt back out there, you little soft butt, man. It's just, you know, it's like everything. I took the mental approach, and that's, you know, it's just all credit back to my uncle, Coach Chris. But back to your question, do I think it hurted me? Nah, it was more so like I really couldn't move. Like, it was a lot of times, man, like my especially my senior year, I had broke my foot 4 times before that, but like my senior year,
well, damn.
Yeah, senior year, man, it was like anytime I lift my knee up, like, my feet would go numb, you know what I'm saying? It was just, I had a bulging disc, a dead disc, a herniated disc, and my dead disc, meaning that my 2 vertebrae was grinding, but it was grinding against my nerve, my sciatic nerve, so my sciatic nerve was leaking every time I lift my knee up, and that's why my foot would go numb.
God.
I didn't know all this until after I finished my senior season, so, you know, I just play through pain, you know what I'm saying? But what hurt me more so than anything, like the team thing, was just a wake up call, just a black coach trying to look out for a young black male, you know what I'm saying? Like, hey, you know, you got opportunities that you could piss away if you don't straighten up your ways. And he gave me a chance by, you know, suspending me for that point of time. And it was just something that I could kind of refocus because.
I like how you worded that.
Just going through.
He looked out for you by suspending you.
Yeah, most definitely.
Because he could have kicked you out.
Most definitely.
That's fire. Good perspective.
Most definitely. He just gave me another chance to kind of like see a different perspective. You know what I'm saying? Like, how to understand that by this point, I understood that basketball is a business. I understood the NCAA business of the basketball. And it kind of like, you know, sucks the fun out a little bit. Well, it did for me a little bit.
Just it'll suck it out.
Just to know, like, you know, the politics of the game. Because, you know, really, like, Texas was kind of like, it had, like, politics AAU-wise, but it wasn't like a Cali or a New York where, right. You know what I'm saying? It was like you knew Cali Supreme, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was just certain teams you
if
knew.
It wasn't
like
football in Texas, it really wasn't as big. So.
You know what I'm saying? And so, like, it wasn't, you started to get the spotlight later, and so you really couldn't, how can I explain it? Like, I didn't know how to really react as being the spotlight dude in a small school, because, you know, OU is 35, 36, 38,000
big
people,
school, big 12. Saying?
It was like 4,000, maybe 4,000 total at the school I was at. So
you
it was
know
like,
to calm down that spotlight there.
You know what I'm saying? So it was like, he was like, hey, you're going to have to, like, you know, like, it was almost preparing me to, you know, almost be a professional, because it's like, hey, like, it's a microscope. You may think, you know what I'm saying, you out here incognito, you right. know what I'm saying, but they see you.
they
know exactly who you are. So anything you think you're doing.
And that's a big environment change.
They know,
too.
You know what I'm saying? Like, East Coast, New Jersey, cold as ever. It's like, whatever you think you're doing, you know what I'm saying? They see it. So,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know how it is.
I'm already low tonight.
Like,
I'm low key with it.
You ain't finna see nothing. And it's like, well, you know, I saw you here, here, and here. And it's like,
oh, I got a call about you being here, here, and here.
And it's like, well, that boy is 3,700 people here. You know what I'm saying? Not 37,000, 3,700.
All right.
You know what I'm saying? And half of them are commuters.
Yeah.
No cap. Like, that's half of them was commuters. So it was like, cut that in half. You hear me? So it was like, the spotlight was just so big. So it was different because my freshman and sophomore year, like, we was good in OU, but like, it's too many people. Y'all was talking about Kenny Stills, and Landry Jones.
The football team overshadow a lot of it anyway.
So it was like, shoot, I was incognito. You know what I'm saying? It was cool. I could be incognito here. So, like, I tried to, you know, kind of do the same things, and it just wasn't working out. And so it was just, he just had to sit me down and just, you know, kind of man to man. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey, just don't work out like that. You know what I'm saying? Where we at right here, you really need to focus. You know what I'm saying? You really need to align your goals, right? Figure out what you really want to do. And he said, maybe basketball is what's really clouding your mind right now. So I'm going to give you some time to really think about if this is what you really want to do. And shoot.
Tough love, right?
Yeah. And so, shoot, I was at every practice. I wasn't playing. I wasn't playing. I was suspended, but I was still at every practice, attentive. I was still, you know what I'm saying? I've always been the kind of person that want to, you know, help my teammates. So if I see something, you know what I'm saying, because I guess I've been blessed with the IQ of this game. So if I see something that, you know, may help you, I'm going to tell you, you know what I'm saying, because I've never been afraid to help a person, even if they become better than me. You know what I'm saying? It's like, I'm not going to block a person of a blessing. You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
big facts.
It's not worth it. You know what I'm saying? Like, life too short. You know
people
what I'm
be
saying?
Tripping, boy. You saying it like that because you thinking about how many other people be hating and they block somebody else's blessing.
I mean, it happened here. You know what I'm saying? Like, my freshman year, like, you know, like a few, like a senior guard, you know what I'm saying? He wouldn't show you a pointer that, you know what I'm saying, a junior or a senior point guard would know. You know what I'm saying? He would be like, hey, they gonna try to do this just so they can fake it so it look like this. But you know what I'm saying? It's like, well, shoot, I'm coming from high school. They don't trap. they don't hard heads. They don't mix them up. You know what I'm saying? Right. They don't ice ball screens. Like, what in the world? You know what I'm saying? He was like, oh, you just need to do flip the screen and you can just treat it regular. It's like, well, I didn't know that. Well, it wasn't until like he graduated where he didn't feel me as a threat, where he wanted to help more. And it was just like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
damn.
Yeah, it's like, it's kind of corny, but, you know what I'm saying, I still respected it because he did, but it's just like, you know what I'm saying, like, you know, back with mom, like, why now, you know what I'm saying?
Why now?
But it's cool, though.
But you like, already knew.
Yeah, but it was cool, though, so, you know, I soak up free games, always free games.
So, so on the flip side, well, I'm feeling you right now. So, on the flip side, you like, I ain't gonna be that dude. So, when you was out, you made sure you gave game.
So when Jordan came up, like Jordan, when he come on here, he'll tell you like, yeah, like I'll be like, hey, look out for this. Oh, we playing this team like to do this and this. You know, they're gonna try to make you do this, but watch this, bro. Don't let them fall for you like that, because they got me like that my freshman year.
Right.
It was like stuff like that, just because, like, I don't know. Sue Surf said it best to me, you know what I'm saying? How you feel when your brother failed, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, how you feel when your little brother fell, when he look up to you, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like,
right.
That's tough.
You feel me? Like, he's like, how you...
And then how you feel determines your true character. If you happy because now you about to, you know what I'm saying, do X, Y, Z, boy, look in the mirror. You might not be the person you think you are.
On everything.
I'm telling you. So it was, I knew, you know what I'm saying, no matter what, I would never be that type of person. And so when I did come back to the team, it was just straightforward. The only thing that kind of messed me up was, you know, I would wait to play, you know what I'm saying? I would like to play against all the high major schools that we was playing against. Because like the year
that's
we went to,
used to though.
The year we went to the NIT, we actually
competition.
You hear me? And we actually led the nation in most neutral wins against, you know, high major schools just because, you know, a lot of them, well, you know, they cut the check to the small school, but we was actually getting the check and getting the dub.
Yeah, let's go.
You know what I'm saying? So it was like, you know, a lot of schools didn't want to play, especially my senior year. Like we tried to play Villanova after they had won they shipped. They didn't want to play us. We played Rutgers and beat them. They was the state school. So it was really like, how can I explain? It's like if Langston came out and just started mopping up OU and Oklahoma State, you know what I'm saying? Y'all just
got to be
like,
bad for business. Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it was like we beat, oh, it was like Langston beat OU at OU, you know what I'm saying?
That's what Monmouth beating Rutgers was like.
And, you know, Rutgers was really like 500 and like, oh, you know what I'm saying? And as soon as we got out one win, you know what I'm saying, they were like, yeah, we ain't playing y'all no more.
Dang.
And we tried to play Seton Hall with Isaiah Whitehead and them. They just want the scrimmage.
I know St. John's ain't want to play y'all.
St. John's, no. Villanova, no. North Carolina. Actually played us. We actually we did pretty good. They was one of the ones that, you know, wasn't afraid to. We wanted to play Duke. We wanted to play anybody that wanted to play us.
Right.
It was that type of.
But them the type of teams, they need the type of preparation, and they need a team that is sporadic, and because them the teams that go deep in the playoffs. Like a Rutgers, a Seton Hall should want to take a page out of their book and play somebody who gonna challenge them to get them ready. Like. People, mindset just be backwards, bro.
But it was crazy because it was like, well, who's the best team in New Jersey? And it was like, well, a lot of people had Monmouth.
Hey, don't forget about us.
You know what I'm saying? It was like, who's the best basketball team in Oklahoma? Langston? Y'all gonna be like,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all gonna be, no disrespect to nobody at Langston, you know what I'm saying?
But they're not like, D1.
You know what I'm saying?
Anybody who knows what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying? But it was surprising, you know what I'm saying? Not to say that it can't happen, you know, it's good hoopers everywhere. It's people from all different backgrounds that's made it places. So if you are D2 or NAIA, just keep grinding because, man, like, a pro's a pro, you know what I'm saying? That's another thing I want to say, like, a pro's a pro. Like, I didn't have, like, the craziest numbers, you know what I'm saying? I was just efficient, you know what I'm saying? Like, that was just my thing. I had Justin Robinson, he was one of my, he was a good guard of mine as well as my little brother, Micah. And they was the go-getters. And I had already had so much experience of scoring without the ball and just making the game so easy. It was okay to like, I took a back seat for my little brother because I wanted him to get everything that I felt he missed out on in those two summers that he was hurt. So I wanted him to get that freshman of the year. I wanted him to get all team. Like, I didn't care. Like, my thing was, another gym, when you go to college, man, make sure you have college goals to become a pro. You know what I'm saying? It's not just to go to college to be a pro. You gotta actually make goals that you wanna accomplish to actually make that route to being a pro actually obtainable. You know what I'm saying? I went to college with no goals, you know what I'm saying? I went to college just to win, which is cool, you know what I'm saying, if that's what you really want to do. I just love to win, so I was a winner, you know what I'm saying? So I won everywhere I was at, and I'm proud of that. Like, I set records at Monmouth, you know what I'm saying? I set records and broke the records that we set winning-wise, you know what I'm saying? So Before I got there, there was a 20 loss team.
Right, upside down.
By the time I left, they was 11-21 before I got there. When I got there, they actually was 500 because I was practicing with them.
Okay.
When I got there, we won 25 games and then we won 28. You know what I'm saying? So I flipped that whole loser column.
Backwards.
It was upside down. I was right side up again.
So like, that was my goal, you know what I'm saying? My goal was to win. I didn't have, like, personal accolade goals that you need to make yourself, you know what I'm saying, presentable. Because all college is a job interview, you know what I'm saying? It's a four-year, two-year, three-year, one-year, whatever. Two-year job interview for your professional career, you know
but
what
that's,
I'm saying?
But that's what Epe Udo said.
Yep, I'm about to say.
He said the reason why he feels like his NBA career didn't go as well as it should, because when he got to the league, he was like, I made it. and I
living life.
And I stopped setting goals. So he had the goals to make it to the league when he was in college. That was always the goal. But he said, anybody who gets in a situation where they're in college, the NBA, you got to set goals to now obtain the next thing, or else you're going to find yourself stagnant. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad you alluded to that, man. That's a major gem.
That's the second time we heard that on this show. So no, for real. That's a like, big ruby.
And like, even when I was talking, like, it was crazy because I was telling my little brother, you know what I'm saying, like, hey, get goals. Like, I want you, like, freshman of the year, rookie of the year, you know what I'm saying, that should be your goal. And it was crazy because, like, I didn't. So it was like, I knew where I messed up, so I was trying to get him.
Yes, sir.
So he actually got the accolade. So, like, that's, you know what I'm saying, fire. How you feel when your little brother gets success? My chest out, you know what I'm saying? Like, but when he fail, I fail, you know what I'm saying?
That's a testament to your character.
So right. It's like, like, you know, I kind of lived through him a little bit, you know what I'm saying? But it was more so of, like, it was more so about winning, you know what I'm saying? J-Rob, you know what I'm saying? Justin Robinson, he was the guard. He's playing in France right now, I think. A-League, Euro
man,
Cup.
Man, when he come back, tell him come holler at us, man. Uh-huh. That's dope, man.
I will, for sure. He's out there in New Jersey and New York. I'll tell him that he actually set the league. He set the league on fire. He got the MVP of the league, I'm pretty sure. But yeah, it was just like, I knew his whole story. Like, his thing was, he wanted to prove. He had so many chips on his shoulder. He just wanted to prove everybody wrong. So
because he was hurt so long.
You know what I'm saying? So it was just like, he had so much built in. He was just trying to go get it. And so, like, I admired that. So I go get it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I know. Like, I was, that's the thing, I was just confident in my abilities to play my game.
No matter what the situation.
And it was like, it was good, but it was also bad because it made me be lax at times where I didn't need to be lax. Because
you thought you can just hit the easy button.
That was easy. For real. And shoot, even then, like, I graduated from Monmouth. I didn't have, like, the craziest numbers. I was just efficient. So,
what you graduate with?
Communications.
Fire. Get your degree!
Yeah, that was one thing I promised my grandmother. She, like, my grandmother didn't ask me nothing. She just asked me to go to college and graduate. You know what I'm saying? And she'd be proud. And that was it. You know what I'm saying?
Straight up.
I always lived to make my grandmother proud. You know what I'm saying? Like, my goals was family goals and stuff like that. Like, I always wanted to be there for my kids. I always wanted to be the one that, you know what I'm saying, my family can depend on. And I always wanted to make my grandmother proud. And I accomplished those goals, but I necessarily didn't set so many basketball personal goals.
Right.
And so that's where, you know, I just want to make sure that, you know, everybody else do that, you know what I'm saying, continuously, yearly, you know what I'm saying?
You,
like,
still got time to make some more goals, man. You're only 26,
for sure,
man. So
for sure.
You still got some time to put some more goals on the board, man. So, entered the draft. Let's talk about, you played for the Mad Ants for a minute. How all that situation go?
Mad Ants G League.
From the draft on to the G League.
Crazy thing is, man, I had that back surgery in May, so I couldn't walk for like a month or two. And I had to actually learn how to walk again.
Wow.
And like my first time picking up a ball, I played, man, I told myself, I was like just working on my like free throws and stuff because I couldn't really move. I was like really working on strictly like being able to move, not so much like skill work or anything else. I was like, I'm fit, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, everything else is just take care of itself, you know what I'm saying? Like, as long as I'm in shape, like, I could miss a whole bunch of shots. I could, you know what I'm saying, I could miss a few layups, make a few bad passes, but I know if I'm in shape, I could play defense, I could rebound.
And it all come back eventually.
You know what I'm saying? Eventually, as soon as I'm a confident scorer. So, like, I know if I see the ball go through the net a few different times,
feeling good.
I'm good. Like, I'm gonna find a touch. So it's just a matter of when. So, I went out for the Bucks tryout, and, like, to my standards, I didn't do too good. I didn't do well at all. But the coach told me, he was like, yeah, man, if you're about 6'6", 6'7", I'll sign you right now. And I was just like,
well, that don't help me.
I can't do that. Yeah, I was like, that's nothing I could work on.
I mean, let me come back with some inserts or something. Like,
give me something I could work on. Don't tell me something that.
And you know what I'm saying? Like, I felt bad. I missed like 2-3 dunks. Man, I was just, you know what I'm saying, jumper didn't feel good or confident. My handle didn't feel that great. But, you know, I played defense. I made the right passes. And my team won damn near every game. You know what I'm saying? Like I really thrive on, like, winning. You know what I'm saying? Just because, like, you know, my big cousin was like... Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So once I finally beat them, you know, I was like, I'm a winner. Like,
yeah, straight up. Look past the winners. You never can look past the winners.
And so that was just my mentality. Like, I just got to win. And after they told me that, something told me, it was like, man, I'm just right there. I really just need them. I was like, shit, I don't even know. I just really just picked up a ball. Like,
yeah. Like, if you made them 2-3 dunks, they ain't having them same conversations.
I just didn't look athletic, which I was like, that's cool. I don't have to look athletic right now. Like, they don't know. I can't really. Another thing, I couldn't really tell them I was coming off of, you know, you didn't really say, hey.
They wouldn't even probably give you that chance.
Oh, you back surgery at what, 22?
Yeah, they would have, yeah.
You know, 23?
They would have asked you for a physical and all that after that.
Nah, ain't no reason we taking a 23-year-old with back problems. Like, nah, 33 with an established career with back problems, maybe. Nah. And so, my agent at the time, he said, hey, I could get you a training camp deal with the Fort Wayne Mad Ants. And,
and it's in your backyard?
Oh, shoot, I'm in New Jersey, this is Indiana. And he was like, hey, I just told him, I said, hey, I'm confident in my ability. I said, if you just get me out there, you give me about 2 weeks to kind of like, you know what I'm saying, train and work out and really like, you know, put a ball in my hand. I said, man, I'm confident that, you know, I'll beat somebody else for a spot. And so, man, I went out there, it was a training camp deal. I was real nervous and I haven't played with an NBA ball. I was really just playing with the college ball. So I was like, man,
boy, them balls suck.
I love them, though. I loved them then, but it was just like I just hadn't had a chance to kind of like
get used to it.
Because the one I had, you know what I'm saying, I was in here working in the lab, and I got frustrated, punted it, lost it. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? I lost it. So I was like, all right, I'm back on the rocks. So I was like, all right, just work on your mechanics. You know what I'm saying? Every ball is the same. Just to keep the mechanics the same. So when I got out there, I must have made like my first 2 or 3. And believe it or not, my roommate was the first one cut. So, you know, it was just kind of like, it's real. You know what I'm saying? It was like 2-a-days, 2 weeks straight. So it was like we added 2.5 hour practices every day. And it's like, I can't really let them know that, hey, I'm really just now getting back into some kind of shape. Like, I'm not really 100%.
So you got to get in shape in the flow.
In training camp, as well as try to, you know what I'm saying, stand out to, like, you know what I'm saying, and you the tech walk on,
basically
you the walk on, so it's like you're probably not gonna get that many reps, you know what I'm saying. And so it was just a fight, but you know, that's something I'm not afraid of.
You fit,
you know what I'm saying. So it's like, it's nothing new. So one thing, kids, man, I went up there after practice, man, I asked the coaches what do I need to do to make the team, you know what I'm saying. I asked the assistant coaches, all of them, and I asked the head coach at the practice, like, hey, you know what I'm saying, like, what could I do to make your team? And he said, hey, if you hit threes and play defense, it's going to be hard to cut you. And I was
so
like,
that was your focus. See, that's great, because now you're not shooting in the dark. Like, you're not just out here wishing you're doing the right thing, hoping, like, you might think they wanted you to drop dimes, and really they just want you to play defense and hit threes. And now you knew that, so therefore you focused on that. Keep going, I'm listening.
Straight like that, and shoot. So, you know, it was like, hey, as soon as you take somebody upstairs, you know, they was getting cut. So it was me and another guy who was actually represented by the same agent. And we was probably like, down to the last cuts, and you know, I was like, man, I'm like, I'm up here talking to everybody. You know, I'm always came in there getting my extra shots in, because like, I'm really trying to, like, they don't know, but I'm trying to like really get like a feel, get a touch and everything. And I was like, man, I just hope I don't get caught upstairs, because man,
the upper room. You hear me?
It was like, man, he going upstairs. Up, he come back crying. I was like, I said, please don't bring me upstairs, please. You know what I'm saying? Because it kind of messed me up, because you didn't know. Like, it was my boy E. Nickerson, man. He was on the team before me.
He was one, the only person I knew there before, and I thought he was going to make the team. It was crazy because we had a scrimmage. He had like 20 cut. And I was like, man, they cutting dudes. Like, he had just had a good day. I'm like, man.
But that's the thing. He probably ain't ask him what I need to do to make the team or stay on the team or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like, you knew this is the role they need.
So that's right. What you
like, I'm not about to be out here trying to mix dudes. That's not what they want.
That's exactly what I wasn't doing. Okay, like, you know what I'm saying? But in one-on-ones, we play one-on-one four spots. I won three out of four. You know what I'm saying? So they knew I could score.
Right.
But I just, what they wanted is what I gave them.
Right.
But hindsight, you know what I'm saying? Give them what they want and then more. You know what I'm saying? That's what I would do differently.
Well, and that's what you get a chance to do in those non-five-on-five drills.
Mm-hmm. Straight like that. And shoot, I ended up making the team. Once I made the team, they told me both my ankles was out of socket. And yeah, it was just like, they just kind of looked at me crazy, kind of like how you was looking.
Like, like, I was like, damn, for real?
Yeah, man.
Because you had to get a physical?
Well, and I eventually told them about my back. I was like, hey, you know, like,
you gonna take a chance.
The reason why I didn't want to go overseas was because of my back. So, you know, now that I'm here, you know what I'm saying, at least I owe it to y'all, you know, straight man to man, before it, if something happens, you know, like, hey, my back, you know, I went through this, and this. I have pictures to show you that it's completely healed. Everything's good. But, you know, I'm just, you know, letting you know I may need a little extra rehab just to make sure that it's, you know.
Physical therapy.
You know what I'm saying? Just to make sure it's good. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to do my part. I'm going to work out. That was another thing. Like, I always was getting my extra, like, my extra lifts. So I was never the one that said, it was never the one that they had to check on to be in the gym or to make sure that he was. They never had to micromanage me.
For sure.
You know what I'm saying? Never had to micromanage. I never was, never been micromanaged because I just get my work done. You know what I'm saying? And it just kind of just carried over. And so once they did put my ankles back in socket, you know, I was like, hey, thank you. Like,
no, that was it. I'm like wondering what was next after they told you that. Shoot,
it was just
that's fire. I didn't know they did that.
It was an opportunity, man. Like, I like, they're one of the best staffs I've ever been a part of, man. They really, you know, took the time. I mean, I'm a G League player, and the Indiana Pacers guys was working on me, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
It just shows, you know, the type of relationship that they actually have with the organization, as well as the type of people the organization is, you know.
Right.
I mean, I haven't been to many other organizations, but I surely didn't think, you know what I'm saying, that
they wasn't treating guys like that.
They would send somebody from the Pacers to come check on this tryout G League guy, you know.
Right.
What I'm saying? But, you know, I kind of had a kid mindset then. I didn't really see the bigger picture, you know what I'm saying? So I didn't really understand that, you know, they had plans for me, you know what I'm saying? I only could see what was happening at the moment, you know? And nothing, kids, they don't give money to everybody. So you got to show that you can actually be a man worthy of that money. So that's why everyone isn't a pro, you know what I'm saying? And some of the ones that can fake it and make it, they lose that money very, very fast. And that's in all sports and all fashions, you know what I'm saying? Like, not everybody can be Kobe, LeBron, AI, Steph Curry, you know what I'm saying? James Harden, you know what I'm saying? It's more so the Carusos, the Dudleys, you know what
right.
I'm saying?
There you go.
Nothing, you know what I'm saying? Nothing against none of those guys, you know what I'm saying? But, you know what I'm saying?
The role.
It's, you got 5%, you know what I'm saying? 5%, that's the Kyries, that's them, you know what I'm saying? Everybody else is free game, you know what I'm saying? It's really off of, you know what I'm saying, like, the relationships you build and create and obtain, you know what I'm saying? You got to show the discipline, the work ethic, as well as your morals, you know what I'm saying? That's what they're going to look at. And what I messed up on was my drug policy, you know what I'm saying? I didn't see the bigger picture because I really had put the weed down, but it was more so of a frustration of not seeing a bigger picture of what, you know what I'm saying, they may have had planned for me, and me being so stuck in the now, you know what I'm saying, I allowed myself, you know, just to fall back into doing what the homies do, you know what I'm saying, just go be cool with the homies, you know what I'm saying, when I done worked this hard to separate myself
from everybody else,
from that life.
you know what I'm saying, why go back now? And I mean, it really wasn't until my kids where it was like, okay, like, I got two of them. I got two little me's, you know what I'm saying? And I know how hard my head was, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, they ain't gonna believe just the talk, you know what I'm saying? They gonna believe the walk. And that's just how I was. And so I don't expect them to be anything less. So I can't just preach it. I gotta walk it as well. And so that's why, you know, I really kind of wanna change my narrative, you know what I'm saying? Just cause family's always been my number one, you know what I'm saying? And I kind of got away from that. Having my kids kind of like
brought it back.
But this the thing, though, narratives don't just change. You know what I'm saying? Unfortunately, you know, we want to say we make a mistake and then we get over it and we want people to believe us. Mm-hmm. But, you know, unfortunately, it don't normally work that way. So what's something that you did to say, I didn't just want to change my narrative, I did X, Y, and Z to work on changing my narrative?
Man, number one thing, man, I got up and got a job, man. Like, I didn't soak in it, you know what I'm saying? I didn't be like, oh, man, like, point the finger, blame anybody else. Like, it was like, I've never been the one to like lie, snitch on, not necessarily snitch, but like push the blame on somebody else that I know I did. Like, if I know I did it, I have no problem. Hey, I did it.
That's on me.
You know what I'm saying? I did it. Like, y'all got me. I'm not going to say, oh, no, it was him. It was like,
nah, this is what happened. This is why I did it. Like, making excuses. Like,
nah. Like, no, I did it. I sure did. I got caught. I did whatever y'all said y'all did. If I did it, you know, I would gladly say that I did not. But you catch me? No, you ain't got to catch me. If you tell me that you made, and I feel like, you know what I'm saying, I know I did that, and you just speak on something, I'm like, yeah, I did it. Like, it's, my grandma always told me a lot of people you're afraid of, you know what I'm saying? And I'm not afraid of no man, you know what I'm saying, but God. So I don't have to lie to you. Like, you can't, like, you gonna kill me, okay. Like, and that's to the extreme part of it, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can't hurt me, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, even then, you still can't take my pride, you can't take nothing.
Fear no man.
You can't take nothing from me as another man or woman, you know what I'm saying? So I was always upfront about everything. And it's more so about, you know, like trying to be something that I didn't have for my kids, you know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't make the mistakes. I didn't, you know, I guess I had a chance, you know, actually make it to the NBA since I was in the G League, and I kind of messed that up. And, you know, to ask for another shot, asking for forgiveness, you know what I'm saying? It starts with, you know, number one, owning up to it, I feel like. Number two, making change. So my change was, you know, if basketball isn't for me, what am I going to do? I got a job. I work at a funeral home, you know what I'm saying? My thing was, I have a family that I have to provide for. I still play ball, number three. I do what it's because it's what I love to do. And that's, I feel like you have to, I put so many hours into, like, that's my craft, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. No matter what, like, I work at the funeral home. I may work somewhere else, but, like, basketball is always, like, my love, my craft, you know what I'm saying? It's just, I got a gift for it,
yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Working on your game.
I'm telling you, you know what I'm saying? Just certain talents that, you know, I have to, you know, I got to pay it forward, you know what I'm saying? Like, when I went to New Jersey, I got a mentor, Larry Marshall, you know, shout out to him. He really saved my life, you know what I'm saying? He told me you got to create an environment conducive of your learning, you know what I'm saying? And that's in anything, you know what I'm saying? So for me, it was, if I want to be a hooper, I need to surround myself with people who wants to better themselves hooping wise. So it's like,
absolutely,
you can't be with, you know what I'm saying, somebody who wants to be a ball player. So ball players can't hang with certain ball players who may look like, oh yeah, I should be there, I'm better than him. Oh, I know. Oh, y'all playing this dude's in here, this dude's there. You know what I'm saying? It's certain people, you know, you probably know hoopers
already
like
know.
That. Like, it's like, you can't necessarily surround yourself around people like that, because that type of environment is gonna rub off on you.
Yes, it will.
And that was just one thing that was the main thing he was just trying to instill in me. Another layman's terms, you know what I'm saying? The company keep is the company you are, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, in the grown man way, he was saying, create an environment conducive of your learning, you know what I'm saying? And once you really understand that, you know what I'm saying, you can apply it to anything, you know what I'm saying? Whether it's
a day-to-day, even at the funeral home that I work at now, I have to create an environment conducive for my learning, you know what I'm saying? So it's certain people I can't hang around, you know, right. It's certain people that I can't necessarily associate with if I really want to get my work done because...
And get back to what you love.
Because if I talk to certain dudes, man, hey, you know what I'm saying? You can work this for the rest of your life, just making this do an hour, you know what I'm saying? Making this $10, $12 an hour. You can do this for the rest
of your
life.
And they'll really trick you into doing something where you look back and you're like, yeah, this is cool, but I don't love this.
Same what I want to do.
You know what I'm saying? This is not my, like, I don't feel like it's something that I have grown to appreciate because number one, I give back to the black community. You know what I'm saying? We service a lot of black community, black families. So like how I look at it is that I'm helping us, you know what I'm saying? I'm giving back to us, you know what I'm saying? In one of the toughest times that it is to be
a minority. Strong,
you know what I'm saying? Like, and even that in a time of mourn, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Which is, you know what I'm saying? You probably feel the most vulnerable. You know, the most vulnerable of your days, you know what I'm saying? When you lose that loved one, whoever that cherished one may be, you know what I'm saying? And so I kind of give myself a little comfort in knowing that I can not necessarily ease the pain, but kind of give help with the grieving process, you know what I'm saying?
And so
that's the part I kind of have to find a craft within my job to kind of give me the focus because... Like, I'm a winner, you know what I'm saying? I take that approach to everything. And now it's just more so, you know, I came up to Oklahoma and was like, you know, I actually prayed. I was like, man, like, basketball ain't for me, you know what I'm saying? Just let me come out here and miss everything. And shoot, I tore it up. And then and I was like, maybe that's just a fluke. I had a stressful day at work, week at work, man, Friday. I was like, man, like... I'm just take it all out, and I was like, shoot. If not, I'm gonna just go give me like a second and third job, and I'm gonna just really take, you know what I'm saying, being the fatherhood and everything serious. And I must have had like 65, so I was like,
65 pointos.
Yeah, 23s, and so
oof.
I was like, maybe, you know what I'm saying, I need to
get back.
Yeah.
So from here on, I mean, I know that's the goal, obviously. So what's your goals? So we can get back into, you know, the hooping environment.
Shoot, right now. The professional way, man, it was really starting with, my mentor has a few different agents that he knows and he's cool with. So he's actually been reaching out for me. He's actually never stopped, no matter what mistakes and everything I've made. Like, he's always been there. He's never been the one to ask for anything in return. So, that's why, I have people that I say is family, but then I have people I say is mentors. You know what I'm saying? Because
they different.
He's never like to this day. He'll never say, hey, like, oh, when you make it, I need this and I need that. And he was like, nah, when you make it, I just want you to pay it for whoever kid, whatever kid I'm helping at that time. So if that kid may need some shoes, I expect you to get that boy some shoes because you was that boy. You know what
Facts.
I'm saying? And it's like, well, shoot, is that it? You know what I'm saying? Because you done helped out so much. It's like, man, is that it? You don't want nothing for you. He said, no, I'm good.
He benefiting off you making it.
I'm good. Like,
he get the satisfaction.
And so that, you know what I'm saying, that's another one I owe it to, you know what I'm saying, not to... And I've never been a quitter, so like, I feel like if I just gave up and didn't try, I would be going against who I am, who I always been. You know what I'm saying? So I have to fight it. I have to, you know, change my narrative. I have to show that my narrative is changed. I have to fight for that because it's just who I am. You know what I'm saying? Like, honestly saying, I make mistakes, and I didn't always choose the best route, and I couldn't see the bigger picture, but.
How old are you now?
26.
Right around the time where men supposedly mature.
Right.
For real. That's the psychology. That's the psychology part of it. You know, they say women mature faster than men, and men mature between, you know, 26, 28, or whatever. So you right around that time, man, and 26 is young.
Yeah.
26 is young for real. So, man, we rooting for you. We Big rooting facts. For you.
Appreciate y'all, man, for real. I'm
glad you came and did this show with us, man, because, I mean, so we want to do it. We'll put them gems to everybody and, you know, help everybody, you know, do what they got to do, so.
Because you did enough in every little area from, you know, the middle school, not playing AAU, you know, transferring, you know, being four-star, getting to college, transferring again, you know what I'm saying? Like, you did so much, bro, and somebody out there is going to benefit from your story, so we appreciate it.
Yeah, man, my main thing is just keep fighting, man. Keep going. Don't lose sight of it. I just kind of got, it's more so about enjoying the journey than the destination, man. Like, just always, because you remember the journey more than the destination anyway. I promise you, you do, man. Like,
boy,
just,
you had like 4 or 5 gems you dropped this episode.
Like, you gotta keep working, persevere, man. For real, that's one advice. That's one thing. That's one of my regrets. I didn't persevere with the bigger picture. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you always need somebody to kind of help, you know, you always need somebody to help. You need mentors, man. You need people to bounce ideas off, man. If you're the smartest one in the room, then you need to get in a different room.
Big
man.
Facts. Hey, we gotta end it on that. Golly, man. Hey, thank you for hanging out with
Hold
us.
Hold on. Pull the ball out.
Hey, my man, that's why you are you, sir. That's why you are you, because you keep me on my toes.
Hey.
Gotta get your John Hancock.
That's a bet.
Yeah, we got some good people on there, man. You give a good show, man. We gotta get the signature.
Right there, Twan.
Oh yeah.
Behind Big Baby Jordan.
It's big head. Same size head as my son. Look,
and you better not drop your son like that.
He drops himself. He drops himself, y'all. Hey, man, when you start training them kids, man, we got 2 young bulls that's not too much away from them, man, that we going to put in the same pot with your kids, man.
Yes, sir.
That's a bet.
Yes, sir. Can I check that out?
Yes, sir.
Ooh, that's fire. 11? That's the number?
Y'all see it. Y'all remember when this thing was pure white.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, send us out.
Thank you guys for hanging out with us as we drop gems that we picked up in these gems. Peace. Man, your story is filled, boy. Appreciate you.
Nah, man, everybody tell me I need to write a book, man, for real. Shoot, all my coaches, everybody tell me I need to come coach their people.
You ain't finished yet. Coaching can wait.
Yeah, that's what I told them. Nah, it's like everywhere I've been, college, professional. Yeah,
that guard you was talking about. You talking about Sam?
Like my life jacket, this ice in my veins is something titanic. Lockdown defense kept me out the center for detention. Divine intervention passes over to my center. Alleyways are the alley-oops. Some got no looks and passed away when somebody shoot. Back in court duo, but nobody hoops.
the wrist, follow through when the cuffs got a loop. Pick a book or pick up and get booked. It's just you and I outrunning suicides. Me, I was outrunning suicide. Boy, I'm going in, dropping gems that I picked up in these gyms. I can't slack, I've been down and back. I'm just trying to share a few tales from this thing called life. Count my assists, man, I swear that basketball really saved my life. Yeah, yeah, I swear it saved my life. Let's go.